Hey guys, thank you so much for joining us for the fourth ever episode of LyfCast. Holy shit, four episodes already.
Four.
Thank you so much for joining us. I am Life is Mine, and here's my good friend, Mr. Tibbins. How you doing, man? What's going on?
Oh, I'm doing just wonderful today.
You having a good day?
Yeah, it's a little hot, but we make do.
Is tomorrow a special day for you?
Tomorrow is a special day.
Oh, yeah,
It's my birthday.
Oh,
I'm going to be so old.
Yeah, you're going to be an old crusty cripple.
Yes, old enough to remember the Atari 2600.
Oh, there you go, man. That's not a crutch in life. It's battle scars is what it is.
It's true.
Yeah. So what's been going on, man? It's been some time actually. I think we haven't done
it's been
a
couple 2 weeks maybe.
Yeah, I think we've done like 2 weeks. Yeah, man. So what's going on? What have you been playing? What have you been up to, dude?
I basically been playing more Battleborn. I have that.
Okay.
I talked about that the last podcast, I believe.
Right.
But I also picked up its competitor, Overwatch.
Oh.
Which for some reason people are comparing these games pretty heavily when they're really nothing alike at all.
Right.
I mean, Battleborn's like more of a mobile game where there's NPCs that you're killing. Overwatch is purely PvP, player versus player. And it's objective based.
Right.
The only comparison between the two games is that they have a large cast of heroes of these characters that you can choose from that all have unique abilities.
The art concept looks a little similar to me on both ends. Like when I see Battleborn and Overwatch side by side, I'm like, I cannot tell which game is which.
It's because they're both very colorful games.
Yeah.
And the character design is flawless in both games. And just the general presentation of both games is done really well. And they're just really colorful and the characters are designed in a really exaggerated way. They're similar in those aspects, but they play very differently.
Mm.
But they're both team-based games, but Overwatch is more, I think it's more on the casual end of that because it doesn't have as much depth as a MOBA. Battleborn's more strategic, I guess.
Okay.
You have to know how to play, when to push those lanes of these minions that you have, when to back off so you don't die. Because if you die, it takes a while to get back onto the field, and your team can be at a huge disadvantage.
Mm-hmm.
I think in Overwatch, when you die, there's not as much of a penalty. You're up a lot faster. You don't usually have as far to travel to get back into the action. So I think Overwatch is more of a fast-paced, more casual game, even though there is still depth there, because you have to organize your teams just like you do in Battleborn, where you need your healer, your tank, your attack class, your sniper. So you still got to balance your team out with those characters to be an effective team, or else
you're just
going to get screwed over. And the thing that I like about Overwatch that Battleborn doesn't do, when you're picking your initial teams on your screen, like you can see who everybody's picking, so you know how to balance your team.
Okay.
There's actually a window that tells you, like, oh, your team doesn't have a sniper, so it's like, oh, you might want to choose a sniper. Your team has no tank, so it has more information on the screen to help you play the game more effectively.
Probably geared for players less, you know, used to gameplay like that, I would assume.
Yeah, I think so. And I think that's one of the biggest flaws of Battleborn that I think why people aren't giving it a chance. Because
they kind of throw you in.
It doesn't have that. It just, you're just in there and you got to fucking tough that out.
Yeah.
Which I eventually did. I mean, I've got like probably 70 hours into Battleborn now, so I understand pretty well that, because in Battleborn you have to learn what all the characters can do.
Yeah.
So like when you're playing against a character, you need to know like, oh, my character can only do this, so I should stay away from that character. And you need to know like what their ultimates are, so you know like what ranges to stay. Like there's so much nuance to that, and Overwatch has that too.
Mm-hmm.
But Overwatch is just more fast-paced action. It's just, and there's no NPCs that you're killing. You're attacking other players. So I
gotta ask you three questions about both of these games. The first question I have to ask you is you're playing both these on Xbox One.
Yes.
So how are the achievements? Are they similar? Like kill so many players on this end, do so many things on this end, heal so many players. Like does each character have achievements? Are they similar? How do they differ? Have you unlocked a whole bunch of them? Because you said you already put some time into both games. So.
I don't think, from what I've seen, I don't think Battleborn has really specific character achievements.
Okay.
But I did see that more in in Overwatch so far. I haven't played Overwatch as much.
Okay.
I mean, I will, but I've been using this one guy, character in Overwatch called Roadhog, and he's this like big, giant, fat biker guy with a pig gas mask.
Oh shit!
And he's awesome. He's like my favorite character.
That's fucking amazing.
His main abilities are he has a scrap gun that he loads like bolts and nuts and shit into, and it's pretty much a shotgun that has four shots to it. So that's his primary weapon, and his secondary like ability that has a cooldown is this hook. Kind of like Scorpion from Mortal Kombat.
Oh.
You can see a character on the enemy team kind of far away and hook them, and they'll pull them all the way to you. So you can pull them into like where your team is, kind of like picking people off.
Jesus.
And you just blast them with a shotgun, you can do a lot of damage.
Wow, that's insane. So you can just like bring somebody towards you, shoot them in the face, bring them towards you again, shoot them in the face. Wow, that's crazy, man.
But I got an achievement for like landing 50 hooks with him.
Okay.
And it was called like hooking something. So I think each character.
It should have been called Get Over Here. I mean, if you're gonna go for it, you gotta go for it.
Well, there's a character in Battleborn called Galt, who is pretty much the same character as the character I just described. He's got a hook, shotgun. Mm.
That's
but one of his voice things, when he hooks somebody, he does say, get over here. He goes, get over here. I was like, oh, shit.
It's weird. It's like, how do these two games that are somewhat so similar get, or like, were they weren't designed in a vacuum or something? I mean, did they not know?
I think Overwatch has been in development for a long time.
Yeah.
And the thing people have to understand is Overwatch is developed by a company that has so much fucking money, like Blizzard, Activision.
Yeah, we're talking about Warcraft. We're talking about
World of Warcraft, which made them billions of dollars.
Right.
Starcraft, Diablo.
I love some Starcraft, my friend.
Starcraft. I love the new Diablo is great. That made them a lot of money. Hearthstone. That's made.
Yeah. Oh, they're just.
So
yeah.
So they have the resources. I mean, you could tell from the marketing. They had Overwatch fucking cups at Taco Bell.
Dude, every time I fucking open up a Twitch channel, it's Overwatch ad.
Overwatch right now is the top game on Twitch.
You know,
Everybody's playing it. It's been advertised to hell. I think that's what they have. Gearbox is, like, tiny compared to them. They don't have a lot.
But well, let me ask you my second question. Do you think that Overwatch is the Battleborn killer? Like, do you think that this game is going to overshadow Battleborn and possibly even snuff out its life before it even gets a chance to really kind of grow its legs?
I think they're competing like that.
Yeah.
But they're two different games. I think it's been skewed in the press and the media that these are, like, the same exact kind of game when they're way different. I don't know. I think it's putting a hurt on Battleborn pretty bad because of that stigma. But,
poor Gearbox. They tried so hard.
And I know Gearbox said this was like their most expensive game that they've ever made too. Yeah. And they put a lot of you can tell they put a lot of effort into it. It's a really beautiful looking game. Everything's thought out really well. They've already been supporting it. Like, all the DLC you get once you pay for the game is free.
Yeah, I remember last cast where you're talking about it. They're going to be releasing 5 more characters, so there's going to be
And they're very receptive to their community. They released like a 2 gig patch on Tuesday that fixed a ton of problems, balanced out a ton of characters that people were complaining about, changed some of the maps, just a little bit of things just to make it more balanced. And they already released a free character already out of the 5 that they're going to be releasing for free.
That's pretty quick, actually. I wasn't expecting that to, you know, have such a turnaround.
No, I wasn't
like
either. And the new character is awesome. It's not like a half-assed character. She's really this really cool character.
Well, that's really cool. Very cool. And then my third question that I want to ask you is, which one do you like better, personally? Which one do you enjoy playing more? Because I'm sure you probably have certain aspects that you like one over the other and whatnot. So
right.
What do you think?
I mean, it's kind of hard to pick because they both offer different experiences. In Battleborn, you're jumping into a game, and those are like 20-minute games you're jumping into. You're like committed. You can't just like quit out and jump into another game. Overwatch is more, I can just jump in and these rounds don't last as long, so it's not as much as a commitment. And I think Overwatch isn't as stressful to play. It's more you can just zone out and play it. But Battleborn, you have to be looking at your map, seeing where other characters are. You got to be focusing on pushing lanes. You got to be looking at what other players are doing and communicating with people. You kind of have to do that to a point in Overwatch. Like, you could do way better if you communicate. But as long as in Overwatch as you have a balanced team, you can kind of just zone out and know what your character is supposed to be doing, and you'll be effective. So Overwatch is more like, I like just playing that and zoning out. Battleborn, I like to have my headset on, try to talk to people. So I mean, I've put 70 hours into Battleborn, so I really like that game.
Right.
It's really up my alley. I don't know. Can I say I like them equally?
No, I mean, hey, that's yeah, if that's what you think. If you know, because
I think they're both really well done games. I think Overwatch has better production values to their art. Like, I mean, it's Blizzard, so you got these awesome animations, awesome voice work. And Battleborn only runs at 30 frames per second because it has more just shit going on, like stuff exploding, colors exploding everywhere. Overwatch runs at 60, and that game runs flawlessly online, and they have all sorts of...
Have you had, out of the 70 hours you played with Battleborn, have you had any problems trying to get any matches, get online, anything? No?
No, not at all. It's always run fine. Overwatch, I've actually been getting kicked from servers and stuff. I guess they were having server issues, but... I mean, I'll give them a pass on that. That game just came out.
It just came out, yeah, you know? Like this week.
So they're, and they've said, I mean, I follow all these, all the games that I play, I follow them on Twitter, and they say, like, they're actively working on this stuff.
Sure.
And Blizzard's good about that shit. And,
yeah. Well, I think that's probably the best answer you could have given, because, I mean, they do offer different experiences, even though the media is trying to spin them in the same direction. Like, they're trying to, like, you know, I mean, it's not like to me like they're trying to, like start a Republican versus Democrat fight or something. You know, they're like,
pretty much,
have a Trump and a Hillary, and they're going to come and fight. And it's like, it's not like that. They offer completely different things.
It's a bullshit thing. Because
and they're not, it's a
if anybody sat down and played these games, you'd realize they're two different experiences. And I think Overwatch is more popular just because it's a more accessible game. It's not something you have to put hours into to learn the minutia of it. It's more accessible,
and it's
been advertised more. They have more money to put behind that, and I'm sure they can afford to give more copies out to Twitch streamers and shit. So
I guess
Battleborn did get hurt by Overwatch because now Battleborn's only $40, which is kind of
$40 already.
Yeah.
Oh wow, damn.
Up on Amazon, and I think it comes with like the season pass too, which
oh my god.
The season pass is kind of bullshit. Like you don't need it. You just get like when they release a character or a new map, you get it a week earlier.
Sure.
Rainbow Six Siege did the same thing with their season pass, so it's not nothing. It's nothing
yeah,
like
it's nothing. Yeah.
It's just like I mean,
it's kind of crazy they would give it away within... I mean, the game came out not even a month ago. I mean, you're talking like maybe 2 weeks ago,
I think they just
want
to build up their player base because they put so much money into this game.
Right, they have to...
I don't know if they're waning... Like, I haven't noticed the community waning at all. Their forums are very active. Their Twitter's very active. And I never see the same people, recurring people in matches online. And I always find matches even at, like, 2 in the morning if I'm playing, so...
Well, it's good to hear. I hope the community stays strong, man. You know, I guess time will tell with games like that because there is a little bit. I remember you said there was a campaign as well, but it is mostly
online
experience. So.
And that's something that Overwatch doesn't have. They don't have any kind of campaign.
Overwatch doesn't have a campaign at all. That's something I did not know. Okay.
No, it's purely online. Multiplayer. They have a training mode where you can just go in and with one character and just fuck around with them just to see how they feel and how they play, which that's something Battleborn doesn't have, which I wish they did, but. I mean, you kind of need something like that when you have 25 characters in the
game. It's like, how are you supposed to know who you like until it's kind of just like they drop you in the middle of a battle and they're like, deal with it, motherfucker.
And you don't want to jump in a multiplayer game, fuck your team over by not knowing like what you're doing. So,
that would have been a good idea.
I appreciate the training mode. That helps a lot. And they also have a bot mode where you can just go into an actual match with bots and not players so you can kind of learn the maps too. Because there's a bunch of different maps and game modes. So
that's cool.
They got that going for them, too.
That's
cool. So, yeah, I mean, I would highly recommend both games. If you want a more deep game that can be frustrating at first, but it's really rewarding, I'd go with Battleborn. And if you just want something that's fun and quick and they don't have to dedicate a lot of time to it, I'd go with Overwatch. But they're both great games.
Oh, that's a good answer, man. A really good answer.
Yeah.
Well, my last 2 weeks were fucking hell.
Yes. Yes, I've heard.
Yeah, I went on a camping trip, and it's been insane. I mean, I didn't have a whole lot of time to play games. But basically, me and my wife, we went on a camping trip, and we got to where we were going, and we have two dogs, and we left our dogs where we were, and we were like, oh, let's go out and just hang out and do some stuff, right? I did take my PlayStation 4 with me, so I did play a game, so I will get into some games here in a second, but basically, so me and my wife, we left, and we came back, and my fucking dogs got in a fight on the first night, and they've never done this before. I have a 6-year-old black lab boxer named Oscar, and I have a 10-year-old English bulldog named Lily. And basically, yeah, they got in a fight. I don't know what the hell happened. I came home. There was blood on the ground. There was hair everywhere. I was just like, oh, my fucking God. You know, so we were way out in the middle of the woods. So we were like an hour and a half away from the nearest vet and stuff. So we had to throw her in the car. She like wouldn't walk and stuff. And she was all just like covered in blood. It was like fucking murder scene. I've never before walked into a murder scene.
Yeah. But
at that moment, I fucking did. It was insane. I just didn't know, like, what the fuck? You know?
Did you think they killed the cat at first?
Dude, I didn't know what to expect, man. I saw she was laying there. Oscar was fucking freaking out. You know, the cat was nowhere to be found. There was just, like, hair and blood everywhere. Yeah, dude.
It was like Bloodborne.
It's exactly what it was, man. And that's what I'm going to be getting to, actually. It was really hectic and stressful as soon as we went camping. And we went there and we had to deal with that shit. The fucking vet bill was astronomical. We fixed all that up. And, she's better now. Both dogs are okay. They're fine. I don't know what the fuck set them off or whatever, but they're okay. Then the other life shit got in the way. The car broke down and fucking all this kind of stuff happened, you know. So it was a ridiculous trip. And that's why, basically, I haven't been here in 2 weeks and we haven't done this cast in 2 weeks. I have put up some content on the YouTube channel, which is pretty cool. And there will be more.
Yeah, there's some good stuff there.
There is, yeah. There we got Eastwat, Windjammers. we got Eastwat, Windjammers. We got Dragon's Fury,
Cheeky Boys,
and motherfucking Cheeky Cheeky Boys. Probably one of the best. I know I look for Cheeky Cheeky Boys in the Virtual Console. It's not there.
Oh shit!
It
really?
Is not on there. Yeah, I was trying
to
find
it.
That's a shame. I would have bought that shit in a heartbeat, but it's not there. So. I did where we were staying. I did take my PS4 with me. I didn't have any internet at all. But I was thinking, okay, this is a really good time for me to get into one of my backlogs. So basically, before I went, my wife Uncharted 4 for a graduation gift. It's why we left. She graduated from school, and I bought her Uncharted 4 because she's a huge Uncharted fan. And we tried playing Uncharted 4, and honestly, man, we got in, like, the first couple chapters, and it's just not what we wanted.
Oh, no.
I don't know. I'm going to give the game the benefit of the doubt. We've played all three other Uncharted. We've beaten them, we enjoyed the hell out of them. And they're great stories, and they're great gameplay. But Uncharted 4 is handled by an entirely different team at Naughty Dog. Amy Hennig.
Yeah, didn't they fire, a couple people?
Yeah, well, Amy Hennig, who penned the Uncharted series, left, and now she's working with Star Wars and Disney and stuff.
Right.
She's actually, I think, going to be writing the story mode for Star Wars Battlefront 2.
Oh, wow.
That correctly. Yeah, because a lot of people were freaking out that the Battlefront didn't have a story mode campaign.
Yeah, they're having a campaign.
Yeah, and she's going to be working with, I think, DICE is the developer on that one.
Who makes
and
Battlefield, yeah.
Yeah, and she's going to be making the campaign on that, so that's going to be pretty good. But actually, yeah, Uncharted 4 was actually penned by Neil and Bruce that made The Last of Us. And the game is very dark and kind of feels like The Last of Us, and it's really weird because Uncharted was more of this, jovial type of game.
Jones.
I said, it was like Indiana Jones. Like, you're Nathan Drake, you're punching guys out, you're just, shit's exploding, you're surviving. Like, right from the get-go, you start off in an orphanage, and then you're in prison, and then you're just like, it's just like, you're getting somewhere, but it just feels so dark and kind of, like, there's this overshadow. Like, the name of the game is called Uncharted 4, A Thief's End, so you automatically go into this game knowing something bad is going to happen.
Right.
There's just this cloud hanging over you in the whole game. And I don't know, I think probably just for us at the time, it was just maybe a little too dark, and we wanted to, we wanted to be a little bit lighter, so probably also about all the stuff that was happening at the time. So we kind of stopped from what was happening. Right. We are going to beat the game, I will complete the game, finish it off, and I'll kind of say my thoughts on it. I did take another game with me, and I took Bloodborne. And Bloodborne was a game that I've always wanted to get back into. I got it when it came out, and I beat the first boss, and then, I'm not really a big Souls guy. I played a little bit of Dark Souls 1, so Bloodborne was, quite the experience for me. I got into it. I didn't know what the fuck to expect. It beat the shit out of me. That beat the shit out of me. I went to a secret area that you're not supposed to go to until way later in the game. It's called Old Yharnam. I go down there. I got my ass kicked. I got my ass handed to me over and over again. You know, I was running through old Yharnam trying to collect fucking, you know, I almost said souls, but for the Blood Echoes, I'm running and running and running trying to level up and shit because I was not strong enough to be there. And then, you know, basically I beat the Blood Cleric Beast or whatever, the boss all the way at the fucking end. You don't even have to fucking beat. And, like, literally, that it broke me. And I was like, I can't play this anymore. So I put it down, shelved it, and then I, you know, on my trip, I was sitting out in the fucking woods in this fucking, like, cabin, and I was just like, let's play some fucking Bloodborne. So, like, I found where I had to go. I got back on track, and I was, like, I was more powerful than the enemies, right? And that's when, yeah, that's when the magic started to happen, right? Like
when it hooked you?
It hooked me, yeah. You started, I mean, I started fighting these massive guys that had snakes coming out of their heads, these big piles of wiggling snakes that were attacking me in the Forbidden Woods. I mean, it was just insane. These massive, like, fly creatures that would jump on you and start sucking your face off and stuff. There were these other creatures that would, you know, they were like the blood, the brain suckers. They had, like, big, like, worms on their face. They would just come up to you and suck your brains, and they would steal your fucking, your wisdom, and your wisdom allows you to buy stuff like fire paper or bolt paper and things like that. But anyway, so yeah, so I fucking ran through the game. I beat the shit out of everything. I got two endings, actually. Opened up the New Game Plus, and now...
Oh, really?
So, yeah, I'm going to go into New Game Plus, and I'm going to fucking try out the Old Hunters DLC. They actually released that a few months back. I think back in November, actually. And, yeah, I'm ready, because, you know, it's such a fucking beautiful game, man. I always heard people, like, defending Bloodborne and saying that it was the best game on PS4, and I understood that when I played it, but I didn't fully understand it until I've actually beaten the game and saw everything that game has to offer. I mean, that game fucking left me shaking and just, you know, fucking, like, just, like, I mean, screaming.
Induce anxiety and anger.
Oh, my God. Dude, I would fucking level up fucking, like, 200,000 Blood Echoes, and then I would get fucking killed by a troll, and I would lose all 200,000. And, I mean, that took me, like, 2 hours to fucking, you know, gain all that shit. So I tried to get back to the point to get it all, you know, and then I fucking would die by something stupid. A worm or something would bite me, and I'd die, and then fucking my 200,000, you know, because I would get, like, near the end of the game, there's these big pigs that give you, like, 10,000 fucking Echoes. So I'm just, like, farming these motherfuckers for, like, you know, and it just sucked because I just, you know, so, but I was very, it's a very kind of crazy game. The story is fucking wild as shit. Holy fuck, I didn't think that game was, but, you know, I really want a Castlevania game like that. The aesthetic of fucking Bloodborne.
I mean, it basically is, right?
I mean, dude, I couldn't, that's all I kept thinking about. I had playing in my head the entire time. I was fucking just, like, running through that world, man, just fucking slaying wolves and shit. It was crazy.
I mean, that's, like, what I thought when I first saw that game, because you have weapons that are almost like whips, like, they're long canes and shit.
Yeah, you get the threaded cane will fucking turn into a whip. You know, you have, you get spears, you get swords, you get everything.
I think that's as close as you'll get to the best Castlevania game ever.
Yeah, Konami's not pumping out any more of those. Nah. But now I truly understand why Bloodborne is the best game on PS4.
That's one game I'm jealous I can't play because it's exclusive.
It really does suck.
It does look like a soul. I mean, that's what the guy that made the game, Miyazaki, that's the type of games he's making now. That's what he's known for, and that's what he likes making. So he's going to continue making games in that style.
I really want a Bloodborne 2, but I don't think we're ever going to get it.
I mean, he said the Soul series is over, and the next game he's working on isn't Bloodborne 2. It's some new IP. He said he's going to continue making games in this style, but I don't know.
I can't wait.
He does expand on them. They get better and better each game that he makes. I mean, it started with Demon's Souls, which became a cult hit.
Right.
And then the original Dark Souls, which was fucking amazing.
Maybe we'll get a Demon's Souls 2. I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, I guess Dark Souls was pretty much Demon's Souls 2.
Mm.
And, and that series is over now, unfortunately. But
yeah, you know,
we'll get more awesome games. But yeah, Bloodborne...
All good things must come to an end, which we will get to. It's actually some of the news we have to talk about today about maybe some games should just die. And we're also going to come back to the actual, that's going to be the topic of the show later on, is about the Dark Souls community, also the Bloodborne community. and things like that. But yeah, no, I mean, it's a fantastic game. If you haven't played Bloodborne and you have a PS4, I don't know what the fuck you're doing, seriously. I think if you have the money, you know, Bloodborne is worth the price of a PS4, unless they release it on PC at some time. But I mean, it's just, oh my god, the game is fucking ridiculously beautiful, and it just plays so well, and it's just, it's so fast-paced. It's so much more fast-paced than what I remember from Dark Souls 1 or from what I've seen from, like, Dark Souls 3 and things like that. So.
Well, and those games are, they're just full of discovery. Like, what, there's so many branching paths, and they're pretty much like weird open world. They're not essentially open world, but they kind of feel like that. There's all these different branching paths you take. And there's just this sense of discovery when you see, like, a new enemy and you're like, what the fuck is that?
I swear to God, dude. I know. You see, you fucking run up on an enemy. You're like, oh, I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I can fucking do this. And then you hit him once with a fucking heavy attack.
You're like, no.
And then it takes off half his life. And you're like, okay, I got this shit. Yeah, and you start hacking away at
him. And then his body splits open. It has teeth. And you're like, what the fuck?
Yeah, you're like,
That's my favorite part of those games is just the discovery aspect where you'll walk into a dark room and see something sitting in the corner brooding, like, what the fuck is that? Yeah. And you cautiously approach it and it just destroys you. You're like, what the fuck?
I remember, love that. In Bloodborne, like, you're in the Forbidden Woods, you're, like, walking through this, like, really creepy, twisted-looking kind of fucking fairy tale woods-like thing.
Yeah.
And there's these big, like, piles of snakes that they're just like slithering around. They just come and start attacking you and shit. But then, like, you get to this old abandoned windmill eventually, right? You know, after you crawl through some cities and some traps and shit or whatever the fuck. So then you get this old windmill, and then you see it's like fucking pitch black in this motherfucker, right? Except for there's one guy walking away from you. In the opposite direction, he's walking down some stairs, and he's the only thing that has light, and he's just walking. He's, like, dragging an axe behind him, and he's, like, he looks a little bit bigger than all the other guys, so you're like, oh, what the fuck? So, like, you know, you sneak up behind him. He's the only thing you can fucking see, and then fucking as soon as you sneak up behind him, his head explodes, and, like, fucking 15 snakes come out of his head,
and he's
fucking swinging this axe at you, and the snakes are attacking you, spitting venomous poison at you, and then he summons some fucking snakes around him and shit, so it's those, like, little fucking, like, 10, like, slithery fucking snakes. He summons, like, 5 of those, so you're like, oh my god! He's like the snake wrangler.
Does that game have, like, the dynamic orchestral shit, too, when you approach, like, big enemies, where it's like,
that's
one of my favorite parts of those games, too, is that causes such anxiety. It plays this, like, super epic, like, crazy orchestral music when you're fighting crazy stuff.
The first enemy on the bridge, it's like really quiet. You're just, like, walking, right? It's like, and then all of a sudden it's like, you're like, where is it? I can't even see where the hell it is. And then it jumps over the church and it's like this massive fucking troll thing. And you're like, and it's like, it's like this, like, metal orchestra music or something. You're like, oh, I'm gonna die. Oh, man. And it's insane, like I'm playing, I started New Game Plus, and it's just like, oh my god, everything is like 10 times harder. I'm on level 100. Yeah, I fucking level up to level 100, and I'm having so much trouble on New Game Plus, it's ridiculous. It's absolutely fucking ridiculous. Awesome. The story is so wild, too. Like, I never really truly understood the story. I don't want to give away any spoilers or anything, but the story is fucking wild. It's just like, oh my shit. There's three endings.
Does it have actual story in it? Because the Souls games don't really have a... you got to kind of pick up the story through, like, the items you pick up and the weapons. I don't know if
it does have a story. Yeah, oh, okay. It does. It's very...
So that's interesting.
It's very cryptic and kind of hard to understand, but it is there. It does have a story. But you never are ever told, like, this is what's happening.
How the Souls games are.
Yeah.
Souls games, like, you have to look online to understand the lore because people will piece it together for you. So I kind of like that aspect, too, where... you're in this mysterious world and you don't know what the fuck is going on.
Yeah, I know.
And there's all this crazy shit. And you don't know where to go.
It's like, is this reality? What is this? How do I get out of this fucking horrible nightmare, you know? And it's like, you can't. Dude, fucking, there's this one part in Bloodborne. You go to this old mansion at the very bottom of the lake after you crawl through the Forbidden Woods and stuff. You go through and fight all the big snakes, and then you come to this big mansion on this lake, right? It's like, and then you fight some shits, and there's some bullshit, and then you go through this door, and you open up this door, and there's this old, decrepit man sitting on a chair, and you go talk to him, and he just points towards this balcony, right? And it's just like, you go to the balcony and look down, it's just water, and you're just like, what the fuck? So then it's like swirling whirlpool below you, so you're like, I guess I gotta jump down there. So you fucking jump down in this whirlpool, and then you enter this, like, I don't know, do you remember an Ocarina of Time in the Water Temple when you fight Dark Link? Like how everything is like.
Yeah, you go to that. Yeah.
It's like that negative world, but it's like crystallized, but you're like walking on water. It looks just like that. And basically, there's this massive spider you have to fight. His name's Rom, the fucking vicarious spider or some shit. And he's this massive spider, and then he's shooting off fucking babies. That fucking guy took me like 3 hours to beat, you know? And it just was like, holy shit, I just jumped off the world and his fucking spider came. It was insane. Under the water, you know. So yeah, I mean, it's just the game is fucking beautiful. It's a masterpiece. It is the best game on PS4, and I really don't think that they will top that game. Like, I don't think Uncharted will top that game. Maybe aesthetically, but definitely not gameplay wise. No way. That game is so fucking good.
Yeah.
I don't even know. I want to try Dark Souls 3 because of it. Because I mean, I'm just like, I want more of this gameplay. You know.
I don't know if it's like weird to say, but I always considered like the Soul style games modern survival horror type games.
I mean,
dude, they kind of have that feel where it's like the evolution of that kind of game.
Yeah, I mean, the descriptions I always hear from gamers, and we're going to get more about this later in the cast.
Yeah.
It's actually our big topic. It's about the community, the souls, and things like that. But yeah, basically, it's like you always hear, my hands are shaking after that fight. I need to just like go away and be alone now, you know.
Yeah.
It's just like, it's like these games break you, you know.
Yeah, and I mean, after you beat like a boss, you feel super fucking accomplished.
Yeah, oh my god, dude, it is. It's good.
Like,
but I'll tell you
what.
I know. It's like, oh my god. I'll tell you what. Let's leave some of that for the end, though,
okay,
when we talk about the community and stuff like that.
Cool.
And then how about we, let's jump into Mr. Tibbins' piece of Raspberry Pi, and then we'll talk about some news. So, what game do you got for us today, my friend?
Well, today for Pi Boys, I got Jumping Flash. And Jumping Flash is a PlayStation 1 game.
It
came out when I was about 12 years old. It came out in like 1995, I think. This is a game I had on my Raspberry Pi because it can play PlayStation 1 games, and this was one I specifically downloaded. It's not a game I never played before. It's a game I have a lot of nostalgia for.
Right.
But Jumpin' Flash is basically a platformer from the first person perspective. In a 3D world, and you're pretty much trying to collect things and progress to the next level. So it's a big open platforming level where you're jumping around trying to collect specific items to progress to the next level. But so Jumpin' Flash is basically, it was a game made in the era where 3D games on consoles were brand new.
Oh yeah, this looks like Minecraft now.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's a very pixelated game. It's very dated, but the gameplay isn't dated. It actually plays really well.
Yeah.
But, and this was back when PlayStation originally just had a D-pad. You didn't have dual sticks when the PlayStation first came out.
Right.
That was something that came later. So this game was designed to use the D-pad. So it's kind of weird playing this first-person platforming game, and you only have the D-pad, so you can only, like, really look around. You can hold one of the shoulder buttons so you can, like, look up and down. I mean, that's something that games like GoldenEye did, too. Like, in GoldenEye, you had to hold a trigger to, like, look, aim up and down and shit.
Right, right, right.
So that's something that these...
I think you also used the C buttons for that, didn't you? For the C buttons help you with the camera?
The C button... I think the C buttons you could strafe around, like, left and right.
Oh, okay, right, the strafe. Okay.
Yeah. You had to hold... I forget. I think, like, a shoulder button, you'd get that red crosshair that you could zoom around with the stick. But, yeah, so this game, you're just using the D-pad. You can use a shoulder to look around. And in Jumpin' Flash, you play this... I think you're, like, a guy in a mech suit, but the mech suit is a giant rabbit.
Like a giant bunny.
It's a giant bunny rabbit mech. And it's basically the same concept of, like, kind of a Mario game, where you jump in the air and you can land on a variety of enemies, jump on them, but you also have these lasers you can shoot out, these little blue lasers to blow up shit. So, and Jumpin' Flash, he has a triple jump, but the cool thing about it is how they got around the camera controls is when you jump once, you'll just jump straight and you can still see ahead, but when you hit jump a second time, your view automatically goes point straight to the ground under you, so you can see what's below you, and that's basically what this game, the game style plays off of, is that you're constantly jumping really high in the air and looking down on stuff that you're platforming down onto. You kind of see your shadow below, so you can see where you're going to land. So, I mean, that's basically That's basically all Jumping Flash is. You're just jumping around, landing on shit.
This game is so colorful, it's ridiculous.
Oh, yeah. I loved this game when it came out, and I played it for 2 hours when I played it again, and it's a really fun game. It's just...
Right.
But you're basically platforming around these colorful levels, and there's these things called jet rods that are in the shape of carrots, and you have to pick up all the jet rods, and then there's an exit platform that you have to land on to progress through the level, but... So there's other things in the level you can do. This is one of like the first speedrun games too, because there's a time limit on each level.
Right.
So you kind of gotta get through it pretty quick, and you get more points
the faster their level. It feels like very arcadey almost. Like,
yeah,
it's all about your score and about having to try to increase your time and things like that. Checkpoints and stuff like that.
You get points for killing enemies. I mean, you don't have to kill enemies, but. There's also specific pickups you can get from killing enemies and that are just around the world. Instead of finding their lasers, you can pick up like fireworks that you can shoot that do big area damage. You can pick up like bombs that do the same thing. So you got kind of secondary weapons that you have to pick up to be able to use. So there's stuff like that. There's pickups that stop time, so it'll stop the clock and you can like move around quick and get the stuff without running the clock down. I think there's other pickups that give you more time on the clock. So there's stuff like that you can pick up that make the world a little more dynamic. But yeah, that's basically it. You're just platforming around this world, collecting those things and moving on. And there's also every, I think, three levels, there's a boss fight. So like the first boss you fight, there's like this big dragon flying around blowing fire at you.
Mm.
You can like jump way up above him and like slam down on him while you're shooting him. And when you hit something... When you land on like an enemy, it bounces. You can bounce back up and keep
right.
like firing down on them. So I don't know. There's never really been a first person platforming game
platformer like this
that.
Before, yeah.
I mean,
Mirror's the only thing that kind of comes to mind, yeah, Mirror's Edge right afterwards.
Right, but this is in the style of old platforming games, but it had its own thing where you're looking at the ground and zooming up and down. And
what do you like about this game? Why is this game special? Why is it a memorable? Game to play on a PS1 or on a RetroPie.
I mean, you were playing games around that time. I mean, when 3D games came out on a console, it was like fucking magic. It was. It's like this is because
like, I remember like Turok and fucking Ocarina of Time.
Yeah.
You know, Metal Gear Solid.
It was really. I mean, it wouldn't look like it compared to games nowadays, but back then that shit was mind blowing.
Sure. Oh,
where
God,
you're like,
yeah.
And the thing that grabbed
you're
me.
Like, you're like, wait,
game.
I can move forward and backward.
Yeah, I can move on a 3D plane. Like, holy shit. But this game, like, really blew my mind back then because you're in this giant open level. Like, I don't think there ever was a game when you're in this big level and there's verticality to it, too. I don't think a home game ever did that, like Jumpin' Flash did. Because you have platforms.
I don't think I've ever seen another game kind of like this before, you know, usually in the first-person kind of mode here. So it's pretty cool.
Right. But there's, like, platforms way up in the air, and you can climb really high. Like, as the levels move on, you can climb really high. And there's a lot of cool different theme levels. Like, there's one called Sky Park, and there's almost, like, Rainbow Road-like roller coasters where you can jump on them, and you slide on this roller coaster, and you have to do all this, like, crazy platforming to get the little jet rods. So there's some skill to it to be able to clear levels. And they definitely ramp it up in later levels. There's... like ice levels, like in Mario, where you can slide on slippery ice platforms, so that makes it difficult.
I hate the slippery ice platforms.
Yeah. But, yeah, I mean, this game just blew my mind when I was a kid, and it's still very much a playable game.
Yeah, it doesn't look so bad, and I mean, you know, I think it would be probably kind of weird going from analog sticks to D-pads today.
I thought it would be too, but as soon as I played it, they designed it so well of just that... jumping in the air and looking down, that solves so many problems. It's crazy.
That does
it's such a simple solution. Because
I know, like,
they had back then, but
when I go back to these 3D first person games that have platforming elements like Turok, or I was recently just playing through the Metroid Prime games. What I always did was I would look down before I made my jump, so
yeah.
I could actually test how far I had to run, you know, before you get to the edge. So,
right.
So yeah, no, that makes sense to actually, when you're jumping in the air, you can look down and kind of distance yourself or set yourself up so you don't miss your jump or the enemy you need to jump
right.
on. So.
Yeah, you can, I mean, you can jump around these platforms or you can keep bouncing off them and shooting down on top of them to kill them.
Very cool.
Yeah, but Jumpin' Flash has that, like I said, he has that shadow of them below him. So they use that as kind of a marking so you know where you're going to be landing on. But yeah, I mean, that's an awesome solution to archaic game controls.
They would have rectified that by making analog sticks so you can control the camera, you know.
Right, that's how they would do it now, but this is just, like, automatically launches your view down.
Yeah, well, you didn't have the technology. Yeah, I mean, that's what they
and
had
it,
to
it,
yeah.
And controls remarkably well in that aspect. You'd think the stick, not having sticks would hold it back, but, yeah, it works. I had no trouble zipping around levels. Yeah, I don't know. I'm sure I don't know how popular the game was. I don't know if you played it ever or.
I think I might have played it once when I was a kid, but I don't ever remember getting like to the dragon or anything like that. Like I think I might have tried it out, but yeah, no. I do remember, you know, running through the worlds and kind of shooting things and like having the perspective change on you like that. But I think it was so jarring for me at the time because it was automatic.
Right.
You didn't actually control it when the camera turned down. I think it just really was like, I don't know how to do this, you know?
Right.
Like it just did not make sense to me. So like games like Turok and GoldenEye and things like that where I could actually control the camera, that's kind of what made sense. But yeah, I think I remember playing that. Because it looked really familiar, but yeah, I think that I just was so taken away by like, oh wow, I'm in a 3D element, and it keeps changing my whole visual, perspective.
It takes a little bit to get used to, but once you do, you can really. The game is just a lot of fun. I think it was really innovative for the time. It just did shit that I never had seen before, and I mean this. You gotta understand this game came out in 95. I think the N64 came out in 96. So
96, yeah.
This was before any of the N64 stuff.
This is before Resident Evil. This is before Lara Croft, Tomb Raider.
Right.
This is before a lot of games back then. Yeah, very early, yeah. You're talking about a year after like Super Metroid and
Super NES games were still being made when the shit came out. So
it's
really crazy to think about. And
there was the Saturn was out though, so you know games
true.
Like Panzer Dragoon and things like that. But
right.
still nothing on
it. It was the early days of this.
Yeah, right, yeah. That's fantastic.
I just think this was really unique. And
well, thank you for bringing that up. Jumping Flash.
Jumping
Retro
Flash.
Pie,
and there was
PS1.
A Jumping Flash too, but I never played it.
Well, hey, maybe we'll have to do a video on it, check it out, and see what we can do. So
badass.
Badass, man. So, yeah, appreciate that. Heard it here. Mr. Tibbins, a piece of Raspberry Pi. Brought to you by us.
By us.
By us.
By us.
So, what, you want to talk about some news?
Talk about some news.
All right, so we don't got a whole lot of news. We got a couple. We got about three stories here, and then we're gonna get back into the topic, which is about the Dark Souls community. But first, the little bit of news that we have to talk about is Sega is making more Sonic games.
Yeah. Why?
I don't know why it is. Basically,
unless it's Sonic Spinball, I'm not fucking interested.
Basically, the official Sonic the Hedgehog Twitter released this image. We silently swear we're up to something good, it says. Here, let me try to scroll down. We silently swear we're up to something good. Basically, here's this image here. So you have Sonic the Hedgehog, and it says, "What gamers think I do," and he's sleeping. "What Amy thinks I do," and he's dreaming of her. "What the internet thinks I do," and he's reading a book, The Guide to Memeing.
Yeah, he wants to go fast.
He wants to go fast. And then "What society thinks I do," and it says 25th anniversary of Sonic the Hedgehog. "What I think I do," there's a real hedgehog just kind of like chilling out. It looks like he's taking a poop. And then "What I actually do," and then it ends with a picture here, "Game development in progress." So very easy or early tease from Sega. And
right,
who
knows what this is. Like,
I really have no idea why.
It's going to be a mobile game, I bet you.
Yeah, I really have no idea what the hell they're doing. But I mean, there is a Sonic game coming out, and I don't really know. I mean, I don't know if this is like a good laugh or why.
Talk about the last Sonic game that you played.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Fucking Sonic Boom.
Sonic
Boom is seriously one of the worst games I've ever played in my fucking life. Like, it's just like, it's a joke. It's a joke. Like, there were aspects in it that could have been very well done, but the game just ran like shit, and it was just not well thought out. I mean, it felt like a fucking Saturday morning cartoon dollar bin game. Like, we made a cartoon, and then we made a game for the cartoon, and not the other way around. We're like, we made a game, and then they made a cartoon from it, like how Sonic used to be back in the day. Like, back in the day, like, you have Sonic 1, 2, 3, they were mainstay games. And then you had the really cheesy Sonic with the cartoon. It was like a really cartoony type of Sonic game, or excuse me, cartoon. Where he was eating chili dogs and Tails was in it.
That.
And Eggman, you know, I think it was still Robotnik then, but then they had the futuristic Sonic one.
That was better. That one was really
It was cool. Almost like an anime or something. It had like
and
a
it
really
was like dark too.
It had a dark tone to it, and yeah. Sally was getting kidnapped and stuff like that, and Sonic, yeah. You know, but the thing was, it was like Sonic was a mainstay game character, and then they had the content of a cartoon and a lunchbox or whatever. That's how you build a fucking franchise.
Sega's Mario.
Yeah, exactly. But Sonic Boom, they fucking made the cartoon first, and then they were like, let's tack on a game. Yeah. I mean, you were running around huge open worlds with no fucking characters at all, no enemies, no nothing. Like, it was just fucking empty. Like, you're like, why am I running through this unfinished game? Like, it's complete fucking utter bullshit. There's four characters. There's Sonic, Knuckles, Amy, and Tails. They all run around together at the same time. They're like a cohort, I guess. And they all keep saying really obnoxious shit like, hey, guys, I'm going fast. Hey, guys, I'm going to go fast. Hey, guys, when are we going to go fast? And Tails like, I don't know, Sonic. And Knuckles is all like this, like, big burfy guy. He's all like, hey, I think I could do that better. And Amy's all like, oh, Sonic, why can't we do that? Yeah. And it was just like, shut the fuck up. It just like was from every aspect. The game was just terrible. So I don't really know what the fuck Sega's doing. I thought Sonic was dead after that game. I thought they learned their lesson. They're like, we're sorry. We won't make anything about Sonic. We're just going to put him back in his like little fucking blue hedgehog.
You're raping Sonic's corpse.
Yeah, just put him back in. Just put him back in there. Stop fucking, you know, having the fucking juicy time with him. Like, get him back in there. It's done. It's done. He's been cooked to way past perfection.
So tell me this, what was the last good Sonic game? How many years has it been?
I mean, to knowledge, I think Sonic Generations was a pretty decent game. That one Sonic Generations came out, I think, in 2012, I want to say. It was like they had the old Sonic with the new Sonic, and basically they crossed dimensions, and like there's this world of like old Sonic, but then there's this world of the new Sonic from like the Sonic Adventure games and things like that, and it was like it worked out pretty well. So like, you know, they were mixing the old with the new, and it just kind of worked. The newer Sonic games, though, they just completely did away with the old aspects. I mean, it's just like Sonic Boom does not show any of the old 90s style of gameplay that we loved, or even the mid-90s, early 2000s gameplay that we loved as well. So, I mean, I don't even know what direction they're going in. It could be a phone game. Who knows? It could, like, literally be, hey, welcome to Sonic 25th Anniversary Edition. Here's a fucking phone game. Did a Sonic 25th already happen? He came out in 91.
I would think so, right?
Yeah, he came out in 91. Wasn't that 25?
Yeah, it would be, right?
I don't know, man. And there's so many spin-offs from the Sonic franchise. They had Shadow the Hedgehog, and they had
Sonic
and
Knuckles.
Sonic and Knuckles was okay. But yeah, I mean, there were just so many ridiculous fucking games. It's just, I don't know. I don't know why Sega continues doing what they're doing with the Sonic franchise.
It's because it's Sega.
I mean, they have so many other franchises they could be working with right now. I mean, they have Golden Axe, they have Streets of Rage. I mean, they have so many different IP. They have Phantasy Star. I could just keep going on. You know, they had fucking Phantasy Zone was a great shooter. You know, why don't they bring some of these games back? You know, and it's just like,
Still making like arcade games, like House of the Dead and shit.
Yeah, I guess, you know, they made Bayonetta.
Alien Isolation.
Oh yes, Alien Isolation. There you go. Why the fuck are they making more Sonic games?
I don't know. They should make Sonic Isolation.
That'd be fucking amazing. Can you imagine? Can you imagine he'd just be like running around? Dr. Robotnik would be like, I'm coming to get you, Hedgehog. And Sonic's all like hiding.
No,
oh,
no.
Fuck. No, my God, you're not going to stop me, no robot.
Sonic has PTSD.
So that is what it is. This is kind of going to lead us into the next piece of news that we have here is, like, should these games be brought, should they keep making these games? Are there certain games that we used to have as kids, like Sonic or, like, TMNT, should these games have just died, and you know, why are they making these games? There's a new TMNT game out. It's called... Infra Manhattan or something like that. What the hell is TMNT?
It's
I don't even know what the hell it's called. It's TMNT. Hold on, let me find the name of it. Escape from Manhattan or something like that. It's not the Manhattan Project, which was a good game.
What the hell is it called? Mutants in Manhattan.
Mutants in Manhattan. Yeah, thanks. And the Turtles games, they're on the same path as Sonic is. You really can't do anything to, you know, kind of revitalize this gameplay style. you know, Sonic Lost World sucked. Sonic Boom sucked. Fucking, I mean, they're just really, even like the mobile games that Sonic had were no good, and the turtle games that they keep making are equally as bad. Yeah. There was Turtles in Time Reshelled, terrible. There was there's this game that just came out. This game is actually developed by Platinum Games, and it's getting like fives. It's getting fours. I think it has like a 3.5 on Metacritic right now.
It seemed like it was probably a quick one-off for Platinum just to make some money for their other games.
I mean, that's basically what it is. And I mean, is that what like our childhood has come to essentially? Is that they're just going to be
one-off? I guess so. They're just like preying on people's nostalgia, I guess.
I mean, it's a fucking terrible time to be a fan of Sonic or of TMNT. I mean, it's always been a terrible time to be a fan of Sonic, actually. I don't think Sonic's ever been really a good game, but still, at least he had integrity back in the day. And so did the turtles had integrity back in the 90s. Now they're just like, they've just been like completely wrung dry for every bit of nostalgia. Oh, could we get another lunchbox out of this asshole? Could we get another fucking a 2 hours? You know, I've heard that this game Mutants in Manhattan only has roughly about 4 hours of gameplay.
Yeah, that's not worth it.
It's just terrible.
It looks like complete shit. I'm looking at gameplay footage of it right now.
I mean, it's by Platinum Games, essentially a beat 'em up where you play four turtles, and I mean that's what turtles have been ever since their inception, except for the very first.
Maybe it's just beat 'em ups are like irrelevant anymore. I mean,
I don't know, because then you have to say like are platformers relevant? Because I mean, Sonic games are in the same boat. I mean, it's just I think it's what it is. I think it's just like the ideas that these two franchises have on them. They've just been wrung dry, and they can't really do anything new. So I don't know about beat 'em ups, because beat 'em ups could kind of like they've morphed into like hack and slash. So we got games like, you know, God of War, Bayonetta, bunch of different games, Devil May Cry series and things like that. So, you know, the hack and slash has evolved. Platforming has also evolved. As we saw with Jumping Flash, you know, it's evolved over the years. Yeah. You know, I think it's just some of these franchises, they've just been kind of stuck in a rut, and they try to capture something that I think the developer doesn't really understand about the heart of the fucking franchise, you know. It's like Sonic was more than a platformer. It was about fucking just being really ridiculous and, you know, like popping off enemies and like freeing like animals and shit, you know? And Turtles were always about fucking beating up fucking foot soldiers and shit, you know? And not these like really drawn out fucking running sequences or...
Well, I think what it comes down to is some of these games, like that Turtles game and that shitty Sonic game, Sonic Boom, aren't AAA games that they're pumping a lot of money into. They're used more as a promotional tool for whatever.
Dude,
like the Turtles game.
Sonic Boom was a $59.99 release.
Right. And it was a promotional tool for the fucking...
For the cartoon.
And they figure like, oh, people will buy this because it's a new Sonic game. And
you know, it's like, the Turtles have never been like, you know, there's been some really bad Turtles games. For example, the last few games, there was, the last one I played was fucking Out of the Shadows. It was called Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Oots. I always called it Toots. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Toots. It was a fucking terrible game, dude.
Legend of the Oots.
Dude, I got the platinum trophy in that game.
Oh my god, why?
I'm like 8% of people that have the platinum. I don't know. I don't know, man. I'm a sick individual. Like,
they should send you a fucking trophy for doing that.
They should send me like a literal fucking golden turtle statue. Like, God, you know, it was ridiculous. And like, there was always stupid shit like pull this off at the right time or do some shit. I don't know, but I wanted to see what the game was about, and it was fucking terrible. The frame rate was bad, the fucking online was even worse, and I mean, it's just like, you know, it's unfortunate because a lot of games have come over from our past.
Right, I mean, so there's a lot of extremely long running franchises that still go on and thrive and make good games, but stuff like this, like Sonic, they just run to the toilet. And
yeah,
they don't really put a lot of money into it anymore and let these D-level teams make games, and they're just piles of shit. Or they have people like Platinum make a game and give them like a month to develop it and say, oh, we need it in this timeline. Like, well, this is all we can give to you by that time. They're like, oh, we don't give a shit. It'll make its money back, and dumbasses that buy it.
Yeah, you know, I mean, at least the Turtles have a good cartoon going for it, because, I mean, it started off as a comic, then it went into a cartoon. And, yeah, the new cartoon's okay. I mean, Sonic has nothing. It doesn't have its source material. It doesn't have the game going for it anymore. So, I mean, it's a huge fucking problem. I don't know. I don't really see any other Turtle games or possibly even Sonic games happening after these.
I mean, Sonic I never really, like, was super invested in. I mean, the original Sonic games are all right. I mean, the first Sonic game I didn't really like. They got better after that, I feel. And Sonic Spinball's awesome. And,
oh, yeah, Sonic Spinball's probably the best Sonic game ever made.
Yeah. And, I mean, the early Turtle games were awesome. But they were all based on arcade games, the old beat-em-up style.
Yeah.
They were great. I think there was even a Turtles fighting game on Genesis that was pretty fun.
Tournament Fighters.
Yeah, Tournament Fighters.
Yeah, that was fun.
I used to like that game.
Yeah, it was ridiculous shit. Actually, there was one on NES. It's Tournament Fighters. It's not a very good game, but it's actually one of the hardest NES cards to find out there. It's ridiculous.
Oh, really? I didn't like the original NES Turtles game. I thought that was shitty and hard.
The original one was so fucking cheap, dude.
So
it was
bullshit.
So fucking ridiculous. I mean, you literally
I don't think anybody can beat that game. It's like impossible.
Oh, I've beaten it. You can cheese that game. Yeah,
What about like that one first level where you're swimming through like
you can't swim.
You can't touch like the
You're talking about the pink swimming part.
The pink stuff. You can't touch it.
Well, what you have to do is you have to go into that world with all four turtles at full length or full health, and you have to sacrifice three of them, and then and then you make it through with the last one. That's how you have to do it. Yeah, you have to have all four of them. I've beaten that game. I swear to God, I've beaten it before.
I've never gotten far in that. I just always give up.
The game doesn't get it. I mean, it's like the boss fights are really fucking stupid. You know, I mean, Shredder in that game is ridiculous. There's actually a part when you get to the very last level, like you're in Shredder's like compound or whatever. There's a level where you can go up to the very top right of this one pagoda or something, this one building, and you keep getting these shuriken scrolls, these like fire scrolls over and over again. So like literally, you go back in, get them, and then you can get like 99 of them, and that's how I beat the game. Yeah, you could fucking just keep getting them and getting them and getting
them. You just cheese the game.
You just cheese the shit out of the fucking game. Each turtle can hold on to him. So, I mean, the thing that sucked the most about it was like if Leo had it and then he died and then you can't transfer items and shit. So that was the only problem.
Right.
But yeah. So I mean, yeah, you could cheese the game fairly easy with stuff. But I mean, yeah, that game still fucking sucked. But you know, at least we got good Turtles games. There's Turtles 2. Turtles Manhattan was pretty good, I thought.
Turtles in Time was a good game.
Turtles in Time was probably the best one. Yeah. You know, and then actually the ones that were on PS2 Xbox weren't too bad. GameCube, they were off the second cartoon. There was another line. There was three Turtles games. They were okay. They weren't bad. They weren't really good, but they were okay. They kind of brought the beat 'em up atmosphere into like a 3D plane, so it was okay. It wasn't.
It seems like series like that, like Sonic and Turtles, they're just. You got to think that those licenses are for sale, and little development companies will probably buy the cheap license and try to crank out a game real quick.
I mean, that's
make some money off it. You know?
That's what keeps happening with the fucking Turtles. I mean, it started off with Konami made the first couple games, and then it went on to Ultra made the first game, and then it went to Konami.
Right.
And then it went to fucking, I think, Ubisoft had it for a while. Activision had it for a while. Yeah. You know, I mean, like so many different teams. Now Nickelodeon owns Turtles, so I mean, it's
right.
You know, there's so many different teams. Now Platinum made this new game with Nickelodeon, you know.
And you gotta think that Sega isn't the Sega of the early 90s. They don't have that money to throw. They don't have a fucking console like to throw money around on it anymore to put time and effort into a Sonic game. So who knows what the fuck this new game is going to be.
Yeah, I don't really know, man.
Or who's making it, who's developing. Is it their internal teams or are they outsourcing? I don't know. There's a lot of... I mean, there's a couple game franchises that should just die, and they should stop just making garbage and just let it go away.
Yeah, I mean, the fucking
because they don't innovate.
My thing is the gaming fucking sphere is way too crowded today with indie, with fucking AAA, with you know, I mean, there's like so many fucking games. I mean, you read the fucking list of games coming out every day. You could literally find hundreds of games on every platform coming out, exclusives and indie and on mobile, everywhere. There's so much gaming content today that it's like, we don't need more shit like this. We just don't. Like, stop making these fucking games. Take your fucking money and put it into fucking things that people actually want, like an Alien Isolation 2 or...
Yeah.
Or fucking give us a new Earthworm Jim and try to make that good or something. Like, just stop ringing Turtles to death. Stop ringing Sonic to death. Like, they've been beaten to death. Like, there comes a point with every franchise, I truly and honestly believe, that you just need to fucking stop.
But I think some companies use shit like this, like stepping stones, like I was talking about. They just put something out like that to make some of the money they need to fund some of their bigger games.
Well, I mean,
look what, like, Gearbox did to that shitty Aliens... game that they released a couple years ago, Colonial Marines, I think it was called.
Oh god,
that was like a huge pile of shit.
Yeah,
but like Gearbox isn't known for making like completely shit games. They just made that to fund like Borderlands and Battleborn and shit. So
yeah, I mean, it could also be said about Nintendo with Metroid Prime Federation Force could be possibly used to fund you know, the next Metroid Prime 4 or whatever the next Metroid game is going to be.
Fuck, I hope so, Jesus.
I mean, it fucking sucks though, because they're going to give us a shitty game to fucking try to get us to, you know, be like, oh, well, where's the Metroid franchise? Oh, well, they're not there anymore because they didn't buy this fucking game. I mean, it's just like, Jesus Christ.
But I always have a fear, like, doing something subpar like that is going to hurt a franchise and they won't bring it back because they'll be like, oh, this didn't perform well.
Exactly.
Like Star Fox, you're not going to see another fucking Star Fox game.
I really think after Star Fox Zero,
I think it might be dead, man.
The franchise may have completely just run its course, and Nintendo may cut the franchise out. I don't really see how they can even do anything. I mean, they tried to go back to the roots this. And
can you make a good Star Fox game anymore? Do people still want that Panzer Dragoon kind of linear, go through a level and that's it kind of experience?
I honestly don't think that they do. And even if they,
like, I think Star Fox would have been cool if they made some kind of big open maps where you have free control of Star Fox, like flying around.
The thing about all of these games, Turtles, Star Fox, and Sonic, is that in their DNA, you can't get away from what they are, right? Like Star Fox at its heart is an on rails.
Sonic
is a fucking platform, is a straightforward platformer. Yeah. Fucking Turtles is a beat 'em up, and you can't really get away from those. And keep trying to do the same thing over and over again without really innovating, but just trying to, like, put a new skin on it or
on Dreamcast
story.
They made that 3D Sonic game. I don't remember if that was
Sonic Adventures. Yeah, Sonic Adventures 1 was okay. Sonic Adventures 2, in my opinion, fucking sucked so much ass. It was just terrible fucking. It was like,
I remember the first one being okay.
This first one was okay. It wasn't really the best. I mean, I felt at that point that Sonic was already kind of running dry, and I mean,
yeah.
But you know, it kind of showed off what the Dreamcast could do and things like that. So I mean, it had its time. It had its place in time.
Right.
But a lot of these games today, they don't have any place in the history of gaming. They need to fucking stop. Sonic Boom is a fucking stain, not only on Sonic, but on Sega as a fucking company. I mean, it's just like, how did you fucking release something like this? Star Fox is going to be remembered as one of the shittiest games that Nintendo's ever fucking released. It's like with these companies, it's like, okay, if you are a fan of Sega and Sonic, which I don't think there are many people out there anymore that are, but even with like fans of Nintendo and Star Fox, like, you know, people always come at you like, oh yeah, Nintendo sucks, whatever, and you're like, no, they don't. They have all these games. But then it's getting to a point where it's like, okay, maybe they are starting to suck. And it's like, how do you go to bat for companies and things like that you love and cherish when they fucking produce shit? Platinum Games. I mean, they are fucking genius. They developed fucking Wonderful 101, Bayonetta 2. You know, they did the new Transformers game. They're working on, I think, Nier. The sequel to Nier.
They're working on like so many games at one time. They probably put their D team, like,
that's
interns
true.
On
yeah, I mean,
making
also,
this fucking thing.
Yeah, they also have Scalebound coming out and a lot of other wheels turning over there. But it's just really, really scary. It's just like, how the fuck do you expect people to buy this shit? Like, how do you do this? Like, do you not care about your audience or gaming or this? Like, I mean, when you think about Sonic and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, these are franchises that are legendary. These are going to, like, live way beyond our time. I mean, people are going to be talking about, I mean, maybe not Sonic the Hedgehog, but definitely Turtles. I mean, TMNT is just, like, there's going to be new reboots and reiterations of Turtles for generations to come. I don't know. It's just terrible that they don't care, that they're just like, we need to get these fucking games out. The developers know they fucking suck. They just are trying to fucking make money off kids and off of fans.
I think it's just a matter of not putting the money into having a good team make these games, and they're not willing to do that. So they're just having shitty. I mean, it was like
B games, D list games that, you know, they don't need to put a lot of money into because people either are going to buy them because they're fans, or they're not going to buy them because they have given up long, long ago and they're not going to be able to be won back by these games. But I mean, why would you even, like, be in that mindset that you can't win somebody back? Like, wouldn't you be trying to win back Turtle fans of, you know, like, make a good beat 'em up again, or make something that really kind of impresses fans of the hack and slash genre, or even of Turtles? You know, I mean, it's like, what the fuck?
Yeah, like I said, I think they just didn't have the money. And But I mean, if you don't have the money to do it and do it right, what's the fucking point of doing it at all? Like,
I mean, that's what I'm saying, except for just trying to make a quick buck off of people. Just,
well, and that's the thing. You got to understand, like, this shit's a business, and you probably have business and marketing people like, oh, we'll just have this game and it'll draw more interest. I think it's just all business bullshit. It's not people that are passionate about.
And the thing that I think it makes it look even worse, because it's like, okay, they made this game. The new Turtles movie is coming out next week or some shit. So it's like, okay, you have a game ahead of the movie, but you're not going to be fucking selling movie tickets on a bad game's back. Yeah. It's like you're not going to be making people want to watch the Sonic cartoon when you're releasing shitty Sonic games. You know, it's just like makes sense.
I think it's just a marketing strategy. I mean, I work in doing marketing stuff with graphic design, and that's how these fuckers think. Like, they think like the gaming audience will be like a big demographic we should market to. How much will it cost to like make some shitty game put Turtles in people's minds? So
the things that I don't understand is like gamers aren't fucking dumb. I mean, like, this is a really expensive hobby. I mean, this Turtles game is $4.99.
I don't think so, but I think
like
young gamers that don't buy their own games and have their parents buy shit for them, they're probably like preying on those people. I don't know.
Yeah, that's sick.
Yeah, or that's like sick. adults that are like in their 40s or early. Late 30s. That,
yeah, I mean, you have old-time fans that are like, oh, here's a Turtles game. I'll pick it up and
maybe,
take it home.
Maybe,
and they
maybe they're preying
hours.
On them like they have kids and like, oh, I'll play a Turtles game with my kids, so I'll buy this. Like, I think it's marketing bullshit like that. So, I mean, I'm looking at it on a more sinister level because that's what marketing is, but...
I mean, it kind of is at the end of the day. I mean, it's so unfortunate that's the kind of realm that we have to live in where... it's just making a quick buck off people. I mean, that's what it is. I mean, it's just trying to make a quick buck off people because it's like they know. I mean, they're not stupid. Game developers are not stupid. They know these games suck. Like there's no marketing being put into these Turtle games or even this new Sonic thing. I mean, this was almost like handled like a joke. Like, hey guys, guess what? We're making another meme Sonic game. You're gonna hate it. We know. You know, it's just like they're already setting themselves up to fail because they've already put themselves in this like arena of shit. And they're just like, you know, we can't come out of it already. So why try? Yeah. Let's just make some more. Fucking shit in these piece of shit engines we had lying around, you know. Like I heard that this Turtle game is actually in the exact same engine as the last Transformers game that came out. That was actually received though. It was received well. But I heard it's like literally everything from the buildings to like the locked doors to
I wouldn't be surprised.
It's like the exact same fucking game, and all I did was put fucking.
I mean, they're gonna reuse assets if they're giving them like, oh, you only have a couple months to make this. Just do whatever the fuck you can.
Yeah, shit it out and fucking somebody will buy it, you know? Yeah. It's just fucking bullshit, man. So, but I don't know. I mean, I would hope that in the future companies learn from this and stop milking franchises because there comes to a point in time when it's like, I think you've done everything that you possibly could do, and if you're not going to innovate something like Metroid did, like Metroid from Super Metroid to Metroid Prime, and it went from a 2D to a first person, gave us a completely new aspect in Samus's life.
Right.
You know, not saying that if they kept giving us 2D Metroid games, they would have been amazing because they would have been, which they were. They did Zero Mission and Fusion and
I think people would still play a 2D style Metroid game. I mean. Shadow Complex did really fucking well. People love that game. It's a cold hit. And all it is a Metroid-style game.
Sure, exactly.
I mean,
exactly.
I think people would still play that.
So, but I mean, you know, there is a lot of growth in those types of games, but I think some franchises just should learn from the past, and they should just be like, you know what? Why? Just stop. Like, stop using money, stop using teams. It just makes no fucking sense why they
do this. Unless you find a team that's really interested in saying, we have this awesome fucking idea for a new Sonic game. We think it could be awesome.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's the only way you're going to get, like, a good
game
like that.
Like, if they were going to make another Sonic game, like, why don't they make a game, like, about the cartoon back in the 90s? Like, I don't know what the rights of that cartoon were, but if they made a game like that in that cartoon style with that really dark kind of aspect where it's, like, the whole
that'd be
world
awesome.
Being... I mean, that would have been cool. That would have, like, brought people back to, wow, okay,
well,
Sonic,
and I think
you know.
People like that. Because when you keep hammering out Sonic game after Sonic game, like, I don't... Like, if they announce, like, oh, here's this new Sonic game, it's just, like, the old ones you used to play, like, I wouldn't really have any interest in it, because I've done that, I've played that. Unless it was, like, super insane and crazy and looked really cool, but, if they said, like, oh, here's this new Sonic, we're basing on, like, this old dark kind of Sonic, we're doing something new, that would draw my interest a little more.
Yeah, I mean,
like, doing something different.
Yeah, I mean, or even with the Turtles, I mean, like, why didn't they ever go back to the source material on the original Turtles, and, like, they always kind of, like, were either, like, the corny 90s show... Or they went to the semi-serious 2000 show. Like, why didn't they go?
Because the original comics are dark as shit.
Why did they go back to that? Like, why didn't they give us a black and white bloody fucking
Turtles? It's because it turned into a children's franchise, so they can't do that. And they,
I mean, I guess it's like Power
they're
Rangers.
Protecting,
yeah.
Yeah, they're protecting their franchise. So.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you could always. I mean, I don't know. I think they could have always had aspects of that stuff without ever going back as dark. I mean, like in the first fucking issue of that, they kill Shredder, you know?
Oh, yeah, it's brutal.
It's brutal as
shit.
They're
awesome.
So.
They're all black and white comics. They were
yeah,
really...
and they all had red bandanas. It was crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kevin Eastman and fucking.
And then they turned it into.
Peter Laird, yeah.
Pizza loving turtles that.
You know, I don't know. I mean, maybe some of that 90s shit should just go away, in my opinion. Yeah, like I mean, like good thing
yeah,
they never
I
brought
mean,
back Earthworm Jim. They'll never bring back Duke Nukem. I think Star Fox is dead. You know, I mean, there's a lot of franchises that never climbed out of that.
I mean,
but a lot did. A lot did. Like there were a lot of really good Castlevania 2D Castlevania games, Metroidvania Castlevania games on the 3D on the DS. You know,
I mean, I'm kind of fine
Order
anymore
McClesian
with stuff
stuff,
like that.
So.
Dying. I mean, if they're just gonna keep making shit, I'd rather them just stop that IP and that line of games, because it's like, what the fuck's the point? You're just tarnishing like what was good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but you know, I mean, they're gonna keep making them because people are gonna keep buying them. You know, stop buying.
Exactly.
Them. That's all I can say. Like, if you're out there like being like, I need to buy these games, stop buying them, and they will stop making them. That's all I can say. Stop supporting this habit. Don't pre-order games like this. Like, I don't even know why people pre-order games anymore. You know, it's just like, just wait like 24 hours. There's gonna be hundreds of Twitch videos and hundreds of YouTube videos and hundreds of everything up, so you can actually see like how it works and plays out. But I guarantee somebody's gonna go fucking pre-order Sonic. Fucking 17,000, and somebody's gonna, you know, I'm sure people pre-order this Turtles game. People are trying to get their money back because it's so bad. So.
Oh wow.
Yeah, and I mean, it's just like you're not gonna get a fucking refund on a game that's broken.
It's a fucking shame, but I think for forever stuff like this will happen. It's just part of business.
It is at the end.
It's just, I mean, that's just the way of capitalism. That's how.
Yeah. Well, do you want to go on to the next topic of news? I think we beat that dead horse to a fucking bloody pulp. So, but yeah, on our first episode, actually, first of all, I want to thank everybody for watching. Thank you so much for hanging out. I hope you guys
are
enjoying these podcasts. This is episode 4. They will get better. You know, we will try to chisel it out a little bit better. Basically, we kind of just like look at the best aspects of news and like to talk about it and break it down for you guys, let you guys know what's happening in the world of gaming. If some of you don't know, the reason these started was because Sunday nights I would actually read over the news to a live Twitch audience, and I felt it was kind of dry at times, and like we couldn't actually break it down a whole bunch because, first of all, it was just me kind of talking to the chat, and I had to kind of respond through texting and things like that, or through the chat. But now I can actually bounce ideas off my good friend Mr. Tibbins, and we can break these ideas down and really kind of spend a lot of time like hammering all these kind of ideas out and thoughts and things like that. So I hope you guys are enjoying it. Thank you so much for the support and the likes and the follows and the comments and all this kind of stuff. If you guys ever have any questions you want to talk about, please feel free to send them into us, and we'll answer questions on the show and things like that.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Yeah, but we're going to keep doing this for as long as we can do it, because it's a lot of fun. We have fun doing this.
Yeah, definitely.
So I hope you guys have as much fun listening to it as we doing it for you. So thank you for being here and hanging out. But yeah, let's move on to the biggest piece of news that just recently broke. There's going to be a new Xbox, codenamed Scorpio.
Yeah.
You want to read a little bit from the Giant Bomb post that you got over there?
Well, I mean, basically what this is saying is that there's going to be a new, more like you said, it's codenamed Scorpio. I guess it's going to come out in 2017. They're going to release a new, more powerful Xbox One that's going to be more powerful than whatever. What's the Neo?
The new PlayStation 4 Neo. Going to be more powerful, so they're already like, our balls are bigger than yours.
Right. And they're saying that they're doing this because it's going to have. Well, they're suspecting that it's going to have integrated Oculus Rift support, so we got the fucking VR wars happening. So, I mean, it's not surprising to see Xbox doing that because they want to stay competitive, and especially if VR
console.
Yeah, as people are becoming more interested in VR, I'm not surprised to see that they want to do this, but, I mean, it's interesting to see the life cycles of these consoles.
So some rumored aspects of this console is going to have a 2 terabyte hard drive. It's going to have a more powerful GPU. And as Mr. Tibbins said, it's going to support Oculus Rift. So Microsoft is actually pursuing a partnership with Oculus.
Yes.
And that's pretty fucking crazy. I don't know. What do you think about this, man?
Oh, I don't know. I mean,
would you buy Oculus Rift if to play on your fucking Xbox One? on your Xbox Scorpio, Xbox One, whatever the hell it's going to be called.
It depends how well it worked. I mean, as it stands now, you need a really fucking powerful PC to be able to play any VR games.
Right.
Because you need a CPU that's powerful enough to render two separate video feeds.
Right.
Because that's how VR works. You're pretty much looking at one screen per eye in that headset. And your video card, your GPU, and your CPU are trying to process two video feeds at one time. So I don't know. I mean, from what I've heard, the PlayStation VR looks pretty decent. People say it's workable. I guess they would figure out how to do it, integrate the Oculus on this new Xbox. But I don't know. I would have to try it before I buy it.
Yeah, I mean, that's always what new tech is always about. You always have to kind of get your hands on it before you can actually sink thousands of dollars
into
whatever. I mean, you're talking about...
Who knows, maybe they'll make a bundle with the Oculus Rift. I mean, the Oculus Rift already comes with an Xbox One controller when you buy it for
PC. It does, right, yeah.
That's why I was like, oh, they're probably going to fucking partner with them now because...
You know, I kind of, as soon as I heard about that controller was going to be in there, I was like, that's kind of fishy. I don't really see them just going to be stopping at controller support. Oh, yeah, of course you could use our controller. Yeah, no, it's like, fucking use our console and get over here. So we can make tons of money off of.
Get over here,
buddy. Get over here. You're going to fucking pull a Scorpion Ed Boon combo.
Well, it is called the Scorpio.
That's why it's called Scorpio. Holy shit. Coming full circle.
I hope it's called the Xbox Scorpio and the tagline is
Get over here. That'd be fucking amazing.
I hope it has a hook inside of the console that shoots out into your chest. It kills you and pulls you into the
console. That uppercuts you in the mouth.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
That'd be fucking insane. It's gonna.
And then there's.
That's the future. That's the future of our gaming consoles. We're gonna start fighting them physically.
I hope so.
But yeah, no, it's kind of crazy because the rumors of the PlayStation 4K Neo, there was people out there that were just like flipping out, and people were just like, "Fuck this! I can't do this. This is too much money. We can't do this." And then all of a sudden, when Xbox rumors start to come out, people seem to be okay with this. I'm not hearing a lot of backlash like there was with the Sony product. For this Xbox One Scorpio, even when Phil Spencer, the head of Xbox, came out and said, "We're not going to be doing that," so I just find this really kind of weird that people seem to be getting on board with these rumors, or maybe it's just a little too early to tell about the backlash because like these rumors dropped like literally hours ago. So,
I mean, I think one of the problems is that these boxes we currently have are still highly underpowered for how fast technology is advancing.
Right.
I mean, I've been primarily, well, not primarily, but I've been a PC gamer for years and years, and I've always built my own PCs, and I'm used to getting that performance of that level of you're going to get 60 frames per second and have good visuals.
Right.
I mean, these console games still aren't at, they can't run games at 60 frames per second, which is fucking insane. Like, that, I don't know. To me, that makes a huge difference. It doesn't matter, but like games like Dark Souls, like you need it to run very smoothly to be able to play well in those games.
Yeah.
I mean, I know Battleborn, I think, runs at 30 FPS, and people don't seem to have a problem with it, but I don't know. I haven't been super impressed with the visuals so far of this generation of consoles, but maybe that's because I'm looking at it through PC gamer eyes. But I don't know. Maybe they're. I hope if they're gonna start making more powerful boxes already, that they're gonna take advantage of the new hardware and processors and be able to give us a better standard of gaming.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know.
Well, according to Kotaku on this, actually, it's kind of interesting because currently Microsoft has this umbrella kind of concept about, it's called Project Helix, where they're going to start bridging together their Windows platform and their Xbox platform. So according to Kotaku, about this whole VR and the newest 4K output console known as Xbox Scorpio, is that the two consoles form part of a wider Microsoft strategy codenamed Project Helix. According to one source to converge Xbox and Windows, for a while now, Microsoft has been clear that they want their two prestige brands to work together, as they've announced big new exclusives like Gears of War 4 and Sea of Thieves for both Xbox One and PC. Developer sources have told us that Microsoft's new mandate is to release future games, including the flagship Halo series, on both platforms. The recently canceled Fable Legends, which was playable across Windows 10 and Xbox One, was one of the first games to implement the strategy. However, so it's kind of interesting. I'm wondering are we going to get a fucking VR Halo game on PC? So is Oculus going to be able to work? Like, how is this going to work? Like, are we going to be getting...
Well, that's the thing. That's kind of why I'm not getting too stressed out about this shit yet. I'm looking to see how these companies are going to market this at... Because E3 is only a couple weeks away.
That's very true.
I'm really fucking interested to see how they're going to spin this stuff and how they're going to value it to make you feel like you need to and want to buy this shit already. Because console gamers for years aren't used to these kind of launch windows. Mm-hmm. I mean, playing PC, I'm used to every 3 years, I have to buy a $500 video card to put in to update, or a processor. I mean, I'm used to that on that level, but I know console gamers are used to, like, I buy this box and it lasts 10 years.
I expect to have this for 10 years. Yeah. And I mean, that's just the way that it's going. I mean, we can't do that anymore. Technology's getting too fast. Game developers need heavier hardware to really start to knock things out of the park. You know, because it was kind of interesting, because when you look at, like, the PS3, Xbox 360, or even like the Super Nintendo or anything like that, really.
Yeah.
Games that came out originally on the console kind of really had shown, like, what the new era could kind of show. But, I mean, like, on games like, on, like, the PS3, like, when I think about, like, some of the launch games that came out compared to, like, I mean, when you think about, like, Mirror's Edge compared to fucking The Last of Us or something like that,
yeah,
like, it was just, like, leaps and bounds away from each other. So, I mean, like, there, you saw this progression.
Right, it's because they figure out how to get the most out of the hardware after a while.
So, I mean, you saw this progression happen over the course of 8 or 10 years or whatever it was. But, I mean, on PS4, Xbox One, you're already starting to see games just, like, utilize amazing new technology. Like, I mean...
Yeah, I think it's because it's easier using, like, the x86 architecture. It's more easy to develop for.
Yeah, I mean, it's like games like Dark Souls 3 or fucking... or even, Uncharted 4 or even The Order 1886. I mean, those are phenomenal-looking games.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, the things that they can do now, it's just mind-blowing. And, I mean, when you think about just, like, a few years... I mean, there's still PS3 and Xbox 360 games being sold today. So, I mean, it's not... But, I mean, the jump from last gen to this gen is pretty amazing. Like, you could really notice the engines. I mean, like, Mortal Kombat X...
It was a beautiful game.
It's just unbelievable. I mean, like, I feel like I'm actually watching somebody die when I fucking play that game. It's kind of crazy to watch that game. So, you know, I mean, it's kind of insane. So it's like, it sounds to me like they've already kind of peaked out on this console gen. They're coming very close to it. I mean, like, games coming out in 2017 may be the peak top performance that we're going to see, and it's not going to get any better than that. So that's why they need higher processors and 4K resolution to really push the limits of what
I think that's going to be one of the big selling points, though, is the 4K. They want that 4K output, because within the next year or two, 4K TVs are going to become a standard. They're rapidly dropping in price, and I think they want to be there when that starts happening more frequently. Right. So
I'm sure. Yeah, they're gonna be everywhere.
Because they don't want to have, like, PlayStation out there is claiming a 4K. That's the biggest reason they're doing this, is because PlayStation is gonna be like, oh, we got a 4K box. Yeah. Like
I'm just wondering how they're gonna actually spin this, because, like, it's just so confusing when a few months ago, or not even like literally like last month, Phil Spencer came out. I remember we were talking about this in the first episode of the podcast.
Where he said he didn't want to take any half steps.
He didn't want to do any half steps. He's like, this is not what we're doing. So, I mean,
well, that's why I'm interested to see what he says at E3 to, like, explain himself. Maybe this isn't a half step. I don't know.
Well, I don't even know, because according to GameSpot, actually, the new Xbox One is going to run faster than the PS4 Neo.
Yeah.
Specifically,
but it's still called Xbox One, right? Or, I mean, Scorpio. Is it going to be a new Xbox?
I'm not sure. I mean, internally, it's according to GameSpot, internally it's being referred to as Xbox 1-2.
Right.
So, I mean, it's targeted to run at 6 teraflops, which is kind of crazy. So, according to GameSpot, specifically the next Xbox represents more than a 4-year-old computational upgrade over the standard Xbox One. It would also mean that the system is more than 3 times faster than the current PS4. According to previous reports, the unannounced new PS4... known as PS4 Neo or PS4.5, PS4K has been a whole bunch of names, but I think Neo is the official code name for it now. Is going to run just above 4.1 teraflops. So we're saying this is astronomical. Like they're saying this may not even be a half step up. Like this may be
Xbox
2. Like that's what it sounds like to me.
That's what will interest me in buying it. If The Xbox One was, they built the whole architecture around, like, oh, sports and fucking, like, that's why they got fucked in the first place. And now we have somebody new on who's like, no, we're about gamings and integrating PC shit into this, so...
I mean, it sounds to me like they're almost trying to maybe get away from the Xbox One completely and just come out with Xbox Two.
Yeah, because that's a tarnished brand. I mean,
unfortunately, it is. It was announced yesterday, actually, that Sony's up to 40 million PS4s sold worldwide. And Microsoft is roughly sitting somewhere around 20 million, I think. So they're lagging behind quite a bit. We don't have the official numbers on them, but I think there was actually a sports game that was released. It was one of the basketball games, and like one of the developers was touting some numbers. And I think he said roughly somewhere between 18 and 23 million. So I'm not 100% on that. But Microsoft never releases their numbers, so I really don't know. No. Unless they come out and say something really big. But yeah, this doesn't sound like a step up. That's a big thing why I think maybe...
No, and if they do a demonstration and say, like, all our games are going to run at, like, 60 FPS and look at the quality graphics we can do. We have cloud processing and shit now integrated. I guess I would be interested. I mean, I was an early adopter of Xbox One. I got it the day it came out.
Yeah, you have a day one edition, yeah.
So what was that, like 3 years ago, four?
It came out 2012, November 2012, I remember.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, I don't think it was very long. Okay. Yeah, it was 2012 or 2013, actually. It might have been 2013. Yeah, I think it's only been about 2 years. Yeah, I think it's only been about 2 years since the consoles have been out, so... But better news about this is that according to Polygon, the publication claims that universal compatibility will be a core principle for the Xbox One range, meaning that the new system will support all previously released Xbox One games. Now, is this going to continue the tradition of Xbox 360 backwards compatibility? I do not know.
I would think so if it's built on the same architecture. I would see why that would be a problem. Because that's like one of their main things that... And they keep adding backwards compatible games. So.
Right. And I am glad to hear that, at least there will be universal compatibility for the Xbox One, because that would be the fucking worst thing that they could probably do is like, okay, we are going to get rid of the Xbox One. We're going to introduce an Xbox Two with Oculus Rift, all these new games, and we're really not going to usher in new stuff. Kind of like what Nintendo's doing with Wii U to NX. I do not think there's going to be a backwards compatible thing with Wii U to NX. I think they're going to be porting games to NX, but I really don't see them like bringing, any kind of Wii U,
gamepad support.
Exactly. Like, I really think they're going to be branding away from the Wii U completely.
I think instead of gamepads, they're going to let you use your iPads and iPhones. I think they're going to add that kind of compatibility into the Nintendo.
I don't know. But, you know, honestly, when we just brought up Nintendo, I think probably the scariest thing for Nintendo at this point is they're going to be releasing a new console that is going to be under fucking whelming again compared to Scorpio and the PSN. Yeah. I mean, they're already...
Because that's
going to
come out in 2017, and then the new Xbox is going to come out. That's why this E3 is going to be fucking awesome and crazy.
Except for Nintendo, man. Nintendo's only going to have... I mean, Nintendo's going to have Zelda. And that's fantastic. It. You know, I'm so happy about Zelda. I can't wait for the new Zelda to come out, but it's just like...
It's like, holy fuck, you have nothing else? Nothing?
How are you going to make any noise with just one game? I mean, I know Zelda's a game everybody's wanted for a really long time, but still, it's just one game.
NX better be something out of this fucking world, or...
Well, I mean, I don't
think they're going to be done. They can't take another big loss like they did with the Wii U.
Well, according to Microsoft E3 plans, Microsoft has announced its E3 conference will take place at 9:30 a.m. Pacific on Monday, June 13th. In March, Xbox Phil Spencer discussed the possibility of console hardware one day becoming upgradable. Microsoft is building towards a future where its games consoles will be upgradable. But according to Phil Spencer, he says, people have asked me before if we're going to do another console, and I say I fully expect that we will, he said. And people will say, well, why do you say fully expect? And then he said, why don't you just say yes, they asked him, and he says, I'm in a job right now. I make decisions based on what's today. I can't always predict the future, but if you think about the strategy we're on, the strategy is a long-term vision that includes multiple hardware generations on both console and, frankly, PC. He also goes on to continue and says, I've said that the end of a generation and this step function that happens is not something I embrace. I think it's something we can do better at. I see it in music. I see it in books. I see it in movies. When I buy digital content, that digital content stays with me, and I'm able to use it when I go out and get new devices.
That's a good sign to me, because he's pretty much saying they're moving to a Steam-like model. That's where you always have these digital games that you buy.
Yeah,
and I think that's awesome because I've been buying all my games digitally on Xbox One. Mm. I had a ton of games digitally on Xbox 360, which have come over with me since they started porting them. So I'm fucking down for that. I like that.
Yeah, I mean, eventually that's what it sounds like they're moving towards. So you're going to be able to buy one game and probably
and plus they have the Windows Store, so you're going to be able to play all those games on PC eventually that they make compatible for both. So
right, exactly.
I don't know.
I mean, these are all rumors. These are all speculation. Microsoft has not come out and claimed anything about this kind of stuff. It is very interesting that we might be getting brand new consoles in less than a year from now. So it's pretty crazy. And it's also pretty crazy that, according to these rumors, the new Xbox will be going for the throat on the new PS4. So I don't.
Yeah.
And you have to think about it, though. I think that the Oculus Rift is going to be more powerful than the PS4, PSVR. So they're going to have console that is going to replicate a PC that will be able to run Oculus Rift, which, I mean, you need 16 gigs off the bat. I mean, you need to have the newest NVIDIA card. You need to have a beefy computer to be able to run this technology. So, I mean, this new Xbox with 2 terabytes of hard drive, it may do it. So, I don't know. We might be looking at a $700 fucking Xbox coming
out. One of the bad things that made Xbox One inefficient at processing graphics is that it had the fucking Kinect running all the time, and there was stuff set aside for that, so they designed it to do that. Part of your processing power was going to that.
With my Xbox, I never even got an Xbox One with the Kinect. I don't even have that. So, I do know what you're talking about. It does have to utilize the Kinect. Mine still looks for it a lot. It's weird. It's like mine didn't come with one, but it has some stuff like say this voice command for this or do this, and I'm just like I don't even have that. Like what the fuck?
I think that's why the architecture is a little clunky is because they designed it around the fucking Kinect, which with that new Xbox, they're definitely going to get rid of that. They're done with it. Yeah. And that'll be great because it's just a piece of shit.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think this next generation, they're going to be... I think it's the generation that we should have been in now. I think both for...
Yeah,
I think all three companies are kind of retaking back... I mean, because that's the thing. Like, when you think... They probably started developing the Wii U, the PS4, and the Xbox One all roughly around 2009, 2010, I would assume.
Yeah, probably.
Maybe 2008. And it was just a different time then. Cell phones were different. Tablets were different. Gaming was different. I mean, it was just a different time. And then in the short little amount of time, graphics cards have gone out through the wall. We've gone from gigabyte to terabyte. I mean, it's just absolutely insane.
Yeah.
I mean, back in 2010, I don't even think you could buy a terabyte. Or if you could, I think people were just starting to talk
about
it.
They were expensive as shit.
They were expensive as shit. People were just starting to talk about it.
But now we're 6 years later. And
6 years.
Stuff's
so,
affordable.
I mean, you're talking about CRTVs that had been around since the fucking 20s. No, the 50s. Not the 20s. The 50s. And they carried all the way up until the 2000s. 2007 is when we got the first LCDs, flat screen TV, everything else.
When
they
were affordable, yeah.
Right, exactly. So, I mean, you know, that was quite a long time. And then we went from LCD to crystal, we went from HD to LCD, and now we're going to 4K. You know, now there's the curved screens. So, I mean, technology is advancing. It's pretty obvious at this point.
It's picking up pace. Pretty crazy.
You know, and I mean, if cell phones and tablets have to keep up with the pace, we're gonna have to do it with consoles as well. It's not a realm that is going to be free and safe from this advancement in technology because it is going so fast.
I think that's what's happening with this period of consoles is that they're trying to figure out how to deal with how fast technology is changing and how.
Right.
I mean, every year, like something happens that changes media pretty much at this point. So I think that's what this whole Project Helix thing is trying to figure out how to bridge those gaps.
You know, I almost look at this kind of like when you play Tetris and like how like at the very bottom you have your fucking shit. It's like dan dan dan, dan and you get your line and it goes away and then you miss a line.
And then it keeps
building up and up and up, and then at the very top of the fucking thing it's just like there's all these holes and it's going really fast and you're trying to get all the fucking
shit. How do we fill these holes?
Oh my god, it's filled up and all of a sudden it's like and the consoles are gonna be dead one day. So I don't know. A lot of people I remember hearing Yields Guillermo of Ubisoft, he was saying that you know, he only predicts one more console gen after this, which may be this one we're entering right now, the Scorpio, the NX, and the Neo. There may be one final console gen.
I think we'll see consoles go away when cloud computing gets to a realistic state. And I mean, like, where you'd have some kind of stick that you plug in, a little stick that you plug into your TV, and that receives a signal from some kind of server that's running the games on it.
Yeah.
And you don't even have a system there. It's just running from wherever Microsoft servers are.
Right.
The games are running from there, and you have everything digitally. I think that's when you'll see consoles go away, where it turns into more of a service, where you have Microsoft service, you have Nintendo service, where you're just playing all these, streaming all these games, pretty much.
Yeah.
And that every year that technology gets more and more feasible, and as they make internet faster and faster, that's when that technology is going to work, and all this shit's going to be gone. You're not going to have hardware on anymore. You'll probably just get a stick and a controller, and that'll be it.
And that sounds like the way that we're moving into, you know. So it's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
It's pretty crazy, man. So yeah, we have about we got about 2 weeks until E3, so we'll know more in 2 weeks.
Yeah, I'm excited. This is like the most excited I've been.
This E3 is going to be insane.
It's going to be crazy.
It's going to be insane. So we're definitely going to keep our ears open and our fucking eyes to the ground, and maybe there'll be some more leaks and things like that coming out over time.
Yeah.
But until then, it's all just speculation and rumors. I mean, this is a very exciting time to be a gamer. That's what building up to E3 has always been like that, you know? It's always been like, oh my God, it's coming.
Yeah.
All of a sudden it comes.
It's like Christmas.
And then last year it kind of sucked. I was like, oh, what? Nothing.
I'm excited this year because
it's going to be different.
The Xbox team is working on a lot of exclusives that hopefully they talk about. So
we'll definitely find out. But you know, let's switch gears real quick. We'll talk about the final topic of the show. We'll end for today. We won't spend too much time on it, but I did want to talk a little bit about this. And then we'll call it a night. But yeah, basically the topic of the show is the Dark Souls and Bloodborne community, which we were talking about a little bit before. There have been some utterances that I've been reading on Twitter, in different podcasts and different places around the internet, that people think that the Dark Souls and Bloodborne and Demon Souls communities are volatile and that they're vicious and that they're just really not a good community. And I really kind of wanted to flesh some of these ideas out and kind of combat them, because I don't believe that to be true.
Yeah, I don't either.
Yeah, basically, people just think that the Souls games are so hard to get into, and that people kind of hold on to these games because they are they're some of the most difficult games out there. They actually pride themselves on being extremely difficult. That people have said before that, you know, that the fans of these games pride themselves on that, so they don't want to really kind of include newcomers, and they make fun of people. And I don't really find that to be the truth. About these games.
I don't either.
Coming into Bloodborne, I've only ever played a little bit of Dark Souls
1. That was the first ever Soul-style game you played, right?
Well, I played a little bit of Dark Souls 1. But I never beat Dark Souls 1, so I don't have a whole lot of experience with it. But yeah, the first type of style that I got lost into and burned myself on was Bloodborne. And I have to say that the community has been extremely open to me. Like, I've been needing help on certain bosses and how to get through certain areas and how do I level up in certain spots like that. And there's always been videos and people just kind of coming out and helping and being
like, I've never been like, how do I get past this boss? And nobody's ever been like, fuck you, noob. Just get good at the game.
I know, and that's what I keep hearing about this franchise, is that the people hold it so high that it is the hardest of hard, and you have to just deal with it, and anybody trying to come into it, like, just die, and, like, that, you know, like, you have to accept death. Like, that's like, the very first part of these games.
It's a part of the game, like, death. I mean,
right.
You're going to die repeatedly. That's a thing built into the game, is
right.
That you die repeatedly, and you learn from your deaths.
Right, and basically, yeah, I just kind of wanted to shine on the fact that if you do need help, it is out there. You know, you can definitely, like, I've gone...
There's endless guides of how to build...
Yeah, I mean, I've gone to the Twitch streamers before, and, like, you know, they're, like, showing me how to do stuff and help me out level up. Like, this is a really good level up spot. We can get, like, souls or echoes or whatever it is you're playing, you know? And, yeah, I mean, same thing with, like, when you're doing trophy hunts or achievements, there's a lot of guides and things like that, so there's a lot of help. So don't believe any of the backwash. Like, if you've ever wanted to try one of these games, or if you've never played a Dark Souls or a Bloodborne or a Demon Souls or anything like that, I highly recommend trying them out for yourself, and not really listen to the naysayers that kind of just don't like the gameplay and kind of attack the community because of it.
Yeah, and I think that's probably where people get that from, is that it's people trashing the game that don't understand it, that go to the community and be like, I don't know why you like this. This fucking game sucks. It's hard. And like,
yeah.
So I think maybe it's like backlash about that kind of shit, because
right.
That happens a lot. especially, like, I follow a lot of the gaming stuff on Reddit, and there's always people, like, on the Dark Souls Reddit, like, this fucking game sucks, it's impossible, like,
yeah, right.
Why do you like this, why is it, like, a lot,
I mean, frustration is a big part of how you have to get through the game. Like, you have to just completely just break down, your fingers start to hurt, and you have to walk away, and then come back in a few days or a couple hours.
But it's a game about evolving and learning, like, it's the biggest part of the game. Like, like in a normal game, you expect like death is this big like tragic thing, but it's not so much in Dark Souls really. I mean, it can be if you can lose shit, but you just accept. There's ways that you can prepare for dying where you don't like have a ton of souls on you. You make sure you use them before, but there's a lot of risk reward to that game, and I think a lot of people, the way current games are made. A lot of games hold your hand and make it so they're not frustrating, but this pretty much straight up says, like, no, you're going to learn something. You're going to learn how to play this game.
Yeah, like, I mean, essentially,
penalized.
The game is going to break you, and then you're going to learn to not do that again. You know,
right,
that's what it
is.
And I've, you know, and then I've never been talked down to by a Souls fan ever. Like, never.
No.
You know, like, people are always really welcoming, and they're always like, hey, this is how you try to do this. I mean, I'm sure you're going to have your assholes here and there that are going to be like, fuck you, you're a piece of shit. You know,
like,
you're
going to
have that
anything.
Anywhere,
yeah.
You know. But a lot of the backlash that I've been hearing recently, just on just different forums and on different YouTube channels and things like that, is just that the community is poisonous itself, and I just I have not seen that, you know, because it's just like, if you need help, like, I think more people would want people to try these games rather than kind of hide from them or be like, oh yeah, I've heard of them, and I just that's not my thing, you know, never say like that's not my thing, like try it out and then see if it's your thing. If you give it a good try, you know, I don't really know. It depends on every person, like how long.
No,
you
and
try
I understand that, like, this kind of game isn't for everybody. Like,
sure.
I have a friend who's like, I don't want to be fucking frustrated for hours and play that.
Right.
And that's fine. That's
completely
not,
understandable.
Not a game for you.
Completely understandable.
I just like, maybe I'm a masochist. I don't know. But
hey, me too. I didn't think I was.
I love going in there and not being able to do something. And then when you finally figure it out and you do it, it's just, I don't know. When I play the Dark Souls games, it's a feeling I don't get from any other game.
Right.
Because of how, like, watered down some game mechanics are anymore, of how you progress through games.
There is no hand
holding. This game, yeah.
There's not.
It's just like, you gotta do this. You gotta fucking do this.
Yeah, as I was talking about earlier in Bloodborne, like, I beat the first boss, and then I was looking for the second part of the game to go to. I ended up in some fucking place I wasn't supposed to go into until I was, level 50, and I was, like, level 10, and I was just like, oh my god, and I was getting killed, but it was like fucking sink or swim. That's, like, literally what, and then so I fucking leveled up, and I was level 50, so then when I went back to the main game, I was wrecking shit. I was, like, way advanced, but I took out fucking the second boss,
well, then
Vicar Amelia,
cool, like,
and stuff like
when
that.
When you wander back into, like, these early areas that you thought were impossible, and then you're just fucking wrecking shit.
Oh, God, it was so
And you're
good.
Like, I beat you!
That was
learned!
And that was honestly probably the best thing that I loved about it, was, like, I died so many times trying to beat this secret area that I wasn't supposed to be in until I was way surpassed where I was.
Yeah.
But then I forced myself and fought my way through all this and collected all these souls and leveled the fuck up, because I was getting mad souls, echoes, because I was fucking leveling up, fighting enemies that were just, like, draining my life with every hit, and I had to, like, roll out of the way, and I had to, like, really, like, learn how to, I learned the game, like, literally, they fucking throw you into a fucking room of venomous, volatile werewolves and spiders, and you're like, oh my fucking god, you're just hacking your way out of it, you know?
It's a technical game, like, you gotta know your timings, right, and just, you gotta learn about what certain enemies do. And their patterns, and yeah, it's hard to explain unless you have ever played one of these games. It's unlike anything out there, really.
It is. I mean, the only thing that I can even think of is, like, the old NES games, really. Like,
yeah, like Ninja Gaiden. Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, even, like, the original Metal Gear, you know, it's just, like, literally sink or swim. Like, just try things until they work, and if they're not working, then you need to go back to the drawing board and try something again, or go to a new area, or try new equipment, or, you know, try to just farm in an area. Like, there's, like, awesome RPG elements where you have to just, like, run around an area and farm enemies that you can't fight so you can level up to continue on and things like that. So, I mean, the way that I figured it out, I, like, literally went into the deep end with just, like, fucking sharks, and I just, like, started swimming as fast and as furiously as I could, because I didn't have a choice.
That's what you had to do.
I didn't have a choice. I was like, I didn't even know I wasn't supposed to be there. I thought that's where I was supposed to be. But then after I beat that boss, like, that was the end of that road. So I had to go back the way that I came. And then I found a fucking way to go down to this fucking church and shit. It was crazy. And I was just like, wow, this is just phenomenal.
Yeah, and I think some gamers just aren't prepared for that experience. Mm-hmm. And I think when those games are initially hard from the beginning, they just say, like, fuck this. Because they don't understand that this is... They don't understand that it's a game where you're going to die and you learn. Like, that's the biggest part of the game.
I mean, that is the whole point. It's like, you have to die, you have to get better. Like, they definitely force you to
But there's no games that really do that anymore that haven't done that for years. And then,
you know, like, fucking, like at the end of Bloodborne, I'm not going to ruin it too much, but there's three endings. There's three endings of Bloodborne, and to get the wishy-washy ending, basically, you accept your fate. To get the bad ending, you fucking have to fight this guy, so you refuse your fate. And then then there's the secret ending, and the only way to get that is to, like, digest these three umbilical cords from these enemies that you found. There's like six in the game, I think, but you get two, but you need three. So then if you ingest three umbilical cords before you fight the final boss, like, and then what you have to beat him on that go, because if you die in that fight, then the umbilical cords go away. So you have to, you're saved. That's awesome. So once you kill him, then the real boss comes, and then you get the secret ending, which was crazy. And that's what I was like,
see, like, I love shit like that.
And I never would have known how to do that unless the community was there for me, which they were.
Right.
Because, you know, they were like, well, here's how you can find the umbilical cords, and, like, this is actually a really good strategy, how to beat this guy, and this is how you're going to beat the next guy. So it was pretty crazy. And, you know, I mean, personally, as a newcomer to these games, because, you know, even though I play a little bit of Dark Souls 1, I don't consider myself a pro or anything with these games, because I never beat any of the Souls games before. I played it a little bit, and it was too hard for me. But I wanted to come back. And I think Bloodborne's a little bit easier than what I remember Dark Souls being, the original one. I remember Dark Souls being excruciatingly fucking terrible.
I've heard it's, like, a little bit easier.
Yeah, it's a little more approachable. I think just with the combat's a little more quicker. You can dodge out of the way and do things. You can actually get stuff like where you can have long-range shotgun or your rifle bullets and things like that. And you can power them up and take damage. So there is some things that you can do. I think it's a little bit easier. You know, in that sense. But yeah, I mean, still, like, coming off of, you know, games like that just hold your hand non fucking stop, it's just like, go this way.
Or that funnel you down hallways.
Yeah, these big fucking pointing arrows. This is where you have to go, you know, and then going to Bloodborne
And Bloodborne doesn't have any the Souls games don't have tutorials. You're just thrown into this world.
Bloodborne has no tutorials either.
What the fuck is this?
There's no tutorials in Bloodborne. It's like literally...
You pick up all these strange objects that have all these crazy stats, and you're like, what the fuck does this do? Like, I don't...
they ask you in the beginning, like, what weapon do you want? Do you want this axe, this cane, or a fucking something else? I forget which one it is. But yeah, it's fucking crazy. It's just like, I guess I'll take the axe. It has the most damage. It has the highest damage given, you know? But then it turns out if you're quicker in combat, you wanted the cane and stuff. You would never know that shit. It's just like, you know, nobody's like going to sit here and like hold your hand through that stuff.
Well, and that's why the community is so good, is that they relay a lot of this stuff. If you want to invest into these games, into the lore, and you really want to enjoy it, like, you can go, it's kind of like a communal thing. That's why I like the Dark Souls community. And that's why I'm on like the Dark Souls Reddit all the time, because people come up with like new ideas of how to put your builds together, because it's an RPG, so you're leveling up stats, you're finding new weapons, you got to figure out what weapons are the best for your build.
You know, and that's what I like about it a whole bunch, is because I'm a huge RPG fan.
Yeah.
And I've
this
never
is
really...
like an insane RPG.
Oh,
like,
I've never really liked hack and slash RPGs, but this game, Bloodborne, Dark Souls, it is.
It's because
really
have the melee, the combo systems down.
Yeah,
like,
that's
they're
what
really,
it is.
They're really precise, really technical.
They're not weak. Every fucking heavy hit that you hit on a fucking ogre or troll or whatever the fuck it is, I mean, you feel that, and they go down and blood spurts out of them.
Do they have backstabs in Bloodborne?
There are,
like,
they're really hard to pull off. They are so fucked. Yeah, because the thing is, the enemies in Bloodborne are quicker than what they are in Dark Souls, from what I've heard from the community, because, like I said, I never really played any. But yeah, no, they're harder to pull off because, like, you know, as soon as you get behind somebody, they're fucking, they 360, or they 180 on your ass. Like, they're just, like, looking right at you. Like, holy shit, I had a split second to get an attack off. And, like, as much as you're, like, lift up your sword, like, they're already coming at you in your fucking face with another fucking hit. And it's like, oh my god. So... You know what I mean? Like, two hits and you're dead, so it's crazy. But yeah, no, I mean, that's you know, that's basically, I kind of want to address that, because yeah. I know you're a really big Souls fan, and right, I am a new fan of the series.
Yeah, I'm glad you enjoyed it, man. That's awesome.
I'm going to get Dark Souls 3 because I enjoyed Bloodborne so much. Awesome. You know, I want to kind of flesh out more Bloodborne. I want to get into the Old Hunters, because I heard the Old Hunters is actually the hardest thing ever released. In the entire Souls franchise. I heard the Old Hunters is like, you have to be like level 150 plus to even step foot into that world. Shit. Yeah, I heard it's fucking,
I remember people being like, some people were bitching about that on Twitter, but it's like don't buy it until you get to that level then. Like,
yeah, and I mean, I fucking fucked up because I'm on New Game Plus, so I
right.
You know, because what you have to do is you have to beat two bosses to get to the you know, the DLC, the Old Hunters. You know, like it
doesn't.
That's
cool. I don't know. I like that.
Yeah, you don't get it from a drop down menu, and a lot of people were bitching about that. They were like, you have to pay 2 or 3 hours to even get to the DLC, and it's like, that's kind of cool though. You go, it's like a whole new world.
I think, like, on the developer's part, that's very trusting of their community to like accept that DLC.
Absolutely.
That you have to like invest in the game to be able to play their DLC. Right. It's not just like, oh, here's pre-planned DLC, have fun.
Yeah.
It's more like, no, you gotta fucking pay your dues in this game to play our DLC.
You gotta earn that shit. Yeah, that's what it is.
That's pretty crazy.
You gotta earn. You gotta beat the two bosses. So, I mean, if you're a New Game Plus, they're even fucking harder. I beat one of the bosses, and I mean, it was fucking a bloodbath, and I got him finally. And I'm leveling. I mean, like, I'm level 100, and I'm having a hard time on the first boss in the game now on New Game Plus. So,
yeah.
So I'm probably gonna have to be like level 200 before I even attempt the fucking DLC. But yeah, I have to beat the second boss, which will probably take me another hour and a half. And then behind where that boss was, if you have the DLC, there's gonna be another door under the altar, and you
that's
can go
awesome.
Down in there, and that's where the fucking the Old Hunters, I guess, lie. And I don't even know what it is. I think it's this whole new fucking world under Yharnam or some shit. So I don't know. I'm excited. I'm excited
awesome.
To try it out and get in there. But yeah, I'm definitely glad that the fucking community will be there, because they have been so nice and fucking you reach out and they're just like, yeah, this is what you do, or this is how you do it, you know, or other people, same thing.
Well,
they're in my shoes, you know.
There's even like a multiplayer aspect to these games where,
right.
I mean, it's not a multiplayer game per se, but
you can summon
other players into your game.
Then they can help you out with bosses and things like that.
Anytime I've ever done that, they will show me secret paths and shit,
mm-hmm.
and they will show me all this stuff that like I have never seen before, and then help me destroy a boss. So it's like, you have like these teachers in the game too that you can pull
right.
in.
So I mean, even more than just going on like boards and forums and things like that, like you actually can get in-game help with somebody that knows
right.
the game fairly well. That has spent like probably 17 playthroughs. You know, they've done
yeah,
New
exactly.
Game Plus Plus. You know, they know the game inside and out.
Somebody
know?
Who has like 18 builds, different.
Yeah, exactly.
Builds,
they're like, oh yeah, this is like my 30th guy. You know?
But I've gone in Dark Souls and summoned somebody, and they'll like you have emotes that you can do where you can point.
Yeah.
And like, I'll like point at a wall and I'll be like, what the fuck is that?
It's a hidden
and then
place.
I'll like hit the wall and the wall will just like disappear. I'll be like, oh my
like,
god.
Oh.
It'll be like a secret area. I'll be like,
yeah.
Holy shit. And that's like, it's really cool that there's people in the community that just like still play that game, and even though they're super high level and just go around helping people.
Yeah.
Like, it's neat.
And that's how you know a fucking good community exists, is because, like,
yeah.
there are people always there waiting to help. Because, you know, like, I've been in communities before. Like, when I would go online and play, like, The Last of Us, like, you just would get stomped, and, like, your team would fucking just leave you to fucking die and stuff.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it was just like, what the fuck, you know? And, like, nobody was ever helping you out and stuff like that. It was a little bit more competitive in that sense, so I guess it's not really a good kind of way to look at it. But anyway, you know, it's like, I don't know, when you want help, it's not really there to be had in some communities and things like that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, no, from what I've experienced from Bloodborne and from what I've also experienced with the Souls series, like, people want people to experience these games. Like, they would rather have you come in and be like, experience this game, die, kind of like, you know, earn your title here and then work on, but if you need some help along the way, we're definitely here to help you out. So, and I always respected that a whole bunch. So
no, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so yeah, don't listen to what you hear, kids. If you want to try some Bloodborne or some Dark Souls, do it. Don't
yeah, I highly recommend
hear.
It
yeah,
that
guy,
Miyazaki, who makes those games, makes really awesome games, and they're really beautiful and unique, so
right.
you should definitely check them out.
I totally agree. Well, I think that is a good fourth episode.
Yeah, definitely.
I think we've gone like 2 hours or something like that. So, but you know, we got a lot of content. We got a lot of news. We got the new Xbox. We talked about a lot of stuff, and we also had a couple topics. So hopefully, you guys go try out Jumping Flash. You've never played it before.
Yeah,
go check it out. We will be getting the next podcast up next week or the week after sometime. We will get it up. But yeah, we're gonna be doing a E3 preview show. Probably would be kind of fun. Probably not next week, but probably the week right after, right before E3, which is going to be the week of the 13th. So, yeah, I think we should probably do, like, what we want. Maybe we'll, like, kind of take some bets on, like, what we think's going to be there and things like that. So, yeah, we'll have that coming up. And then any other kind of news to fill in on, you know, we'll make it happen. So,
yeah.
But I think that was a good episode 4. I say we're going to go ahead. Do you have anything else you want to add, man?
That's all, man. I think we summed everything up pretty good.
Sounds good to me, dude. Well, thank you guys for joining us. Thank you so much for hanging out. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you so much for listening or watching, and we will see you guys the next time for the 5th episode. Maybe we'll just skip 5 and go right to 10. All
right, I'm good.
And then people will come in and be like, where the fuck did the last
episode
5
100.
All right, have a good one, guys. Thanks for hanging out. We'll see you next time.